is enough! I have had it!
Why so serious?
And we hold the world ransom for...
Wayne Gandy.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Show me.
Broadcasting live from the Armada FM studios in Atlanta, Georgia. This is the Sports Joc Show with Wayne Gandy.
You may fill me up, fill me up, yeah. Can you fill me up, yeah? You won't break me down. I've come too far. Come too far, yeah. Yeah, I've come too far, yeah. So just now, hey. It's a new day. I'ma do it. Yeah, I'm gonna go all the way. You may fill me up.
Welcome, welcome, welcome. Good morning to you. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. You're listening to the Sports Joc Show. It is 9 a.m. It is Monday morning. If you're in the city of Atlanta, keep your umbrella. It's supposed to rain about 7 days in a row. 2,000-3,000 years ago, you know, the ark and all that, picking up animals, that kind of stuff. But y'all only care about dogs anyway, so the ark would have just been full of Pomeranians and pit bulls. They'd tuck in. They're going to take over the world eventually. Dogs. Forget Planet of the Apes. It's going to be Planet of the Chihuahuas. Something like that. That's not going to be a good movie, though. Not at all talking Chihuahuas. But good morning to you. We have a great show for you. The funny man, Big Kenny, is here with me. Hopefully, we will get Miss Erica Ash in her seat as well today. Later in the show, we're going to talk to Sekou Smith and my man, Vonnie Holiday. Should step in the studio in about an hour. And later on, we, here on the Sports Joc Show, we pay a lot of attention to the off-brand sports and competitions. Miss Wheelchair America. I know we've had our jokes and things about that, but we have Miss Georgia, Miss Wheelchair Georgia, stepping in, Miss Leslie Peoples. Later in the show, we will see how that goes. Our place is not wheelchair accessible, but we're going to make it work. You know, we got some thick neck, big back guys around here that can carry more than their own weight. But we have a great show for you. The Sports Joc went out to the opening season lingerie. Excuse me. They changed the name. It's no longer Lingerie Football League. It is now Legends Football League. I don't know what legends they are, but they are still in. If you're looking at the Sports Joc page, Big Kenny, they're still in their bikinis. But it's great action, big crowd. They had former Falcon running back Jamal Anderson do the coin toss. I saw the gentleman that actually recruited me to go to Auburn, Auburn All-American Ed King. He was in the building. Keep your head up, bro. He's from Phoenix City, Alabama. He's going through a divorce. I think this is his third divorce, but I have to check with him. But he keeps trying. You know, they say that's some kind of definition of insanity, but he keeps putting it out there. Let's get one more pick of that Legends football picture. It's going on. Their next game here in Atlanta, the Atlanta Steam was going against the Chicago Bliss. That's the Steam in the black and the Bliss in the white. Chicago Bliss won this matchup. But I know you're looking and you see them in the little bikini bottoms. But the girls do get at it. It's kind of no holds barred. There is no personal fouls. They curse each other out. As I told you last year when Atlanta Steam was playing the Jacksonville team, the Jacksonville player even punched the Atlanta Steam's head coach after the game. So it gets wild. You know, just want a cold beer and you got a couple of dollars, go up to the Gwinnett Arena on May the 2nd. And they're playing a team out of Omaha. Who knew Omaha would even have enough people to put a team together? But, May 2nd, a lot of things going on May 2nd, isn't it? We'll talk about that a little later in the show. But that was the Steam playing. See, it's physical, man. It gets physical right there. Just in case you forgot, they will knock each other out. I mean, that really goes on. I like to get in the first row and get a little sweat on me, but they try to knock you out. They hit that spray tan on, and that's the Jackson. Actually, that last picture, They go at it now. You think I'm telling you every guy, I took a couple of my friends, it was their first time, all of them are fans. All of them told me to let them know the next game. It is a lot of action. It's at the Gwinnett Center. And even when I was sitting there, I was thinking, wow, if this was a little closer to the city, they'd probably get a much bigger crowd. But there was probably at least 3,000 people in the arena up in the Gwinnett Center to see the Steam, the Atlanta Steam, Chicago Bliss. But we, you know, the Final Four is over. We're going to give some love to Connecticut and Duke a little later in the show. I know I might should stay save that for Vonnie Holiday. He went to North Carolina. Make sure we ask Vonnie, did he actually go to North Carolina? You know, they kind of suspect, but we have to ask. They was making up them classes. That should have been around the time he was there. But great friend of mine, Vonnie Holiday. One story that kind of went under the radar, that it's always funny how certain stories don't get a lot of play. And I don't know if you heard this out there, but I have to talk about this first. The Ottawa Fury football team was on a plane from Canada to Atlanta to play the Atlanta Silverbacks on Saturday. One of their players, Oliver Menantel, was on the plane, taking a nap. Not a private plane, just a commercial flight, taking a nap. He woke up, and the passenger next to him was choking him with his phone call cord. That's how he woke up. His teammates had to rescue him. The guy beside him just lost it for a minute and actually started choking him with his phone cord. They did not release the name of the gentleman that was doing this. Oliver is okay. They say that he did play that night in the game. He's 22 years old, but he was napping, and I guess he might have been in the back. If he's a young player, he probably had some of the worst seats in the back. But whoever was sitting next to him decided to try to kill him. So I just, you know, you wonder why these stories don't open up the news. This is more thrilling than who sunk a hole in one. To actually be on a plane napping, and the guy decides to choke you. So we'll see how this goes, attempted murder, or how that works. But I just thought that that was a strange story to go under the radar. You know, it's funny how I take $300 from a coach, I can get national attention. But if I get choked out on an airplane by Apple Corps, what is that? I wonder if he used the cord for his phone or the little earphones in the seat. Anybody think? No, just me. But we'll see how this goes. But before we go any further, I'm going to bring my co-host on, Mr. Big Kenny, Chicago's finest in the building. Good morning to you, Big Kenny. You ever sat by somebody and wanted to choke them out?
Sports Joc, good morning. First, let me say, I'm not saying nobody should be murdering nobody. I'm just saying I understand the struggle of the business traveler flying next to the recreational traveler. The business traveler, this dude's got stuff on his mind. He focused. He got a meeting to get to. He's trying to regulate how much overhead space he can use to keep his presentation. Uh-huh. And Mr. Football players coming off an all-night bender. He's been drinking and popping pills and smoking hash with strippers and all of that. And he's all laid across the seat like everything is sweet. Mm-hmm. And dude probably just saw that little phone in the back of the headrest and thought, you know what? I'm going to strangle this man. And it's like an impulse action. You know, I'm going to just strangle this man. And then in the middle of strangling him, thought, wow, this is probably not the best option.
It is. Some things you just never think is going to happen, though. I didn't know. It's hard for me to fall asleep on flights anyway, because if I'm in coach, I have no leg room. If I'm in first class, the person next to me always wants to use the bathroom. Well, it just doesn't work for me. I don't know. I might have to just start buying two seats.
I always size up the person sitting next to me on one of two criteria. Would they be Mile High Club candidates or not. I never thought, will this person choke me out? You know what I mean? So now I got to add another. Like, okay, will they be a Mile High candidate or will they strangle me to death? And you said some things you don't expect, but then some things you kind of expect. When you said Jamal Anderson in Legends Football, I was thinking, did he suit up? You know what I mean? Did Jamal throw on the little skin-tight panties and the bra and get out there with him? But he was doing the coin toss. Great sighting of Jamal. You know, we hadn't seen him.
Yeah, he's put on a good coating of about 32 pounds of extra weight. Really? So when they first said it, I was looking for him, and I didn't realize that was him until he started doing a little dirty bird for him.
Right, right. And got winded with the look. Yeah, y'all remember that dance.
And I kept thinking, man, I did not know you could gain weight on cocaine.
Wow.
I didn't know you could gain weight on cocaine. I thought cocaine was like the number one diet substance that you could take.
Well, when you try and get off of heroin and stuff like that and cocaine, they give you methadone, which sort of adds a little weight. So maybe he's rehabbing.
Maybe that's what it is. Yeah. Maybe he's in his rehab stage.
Or maybe he just found a stripper that can cook.
But Jamal Anderson, we love. He was a great running back. Can't take that away from him. Actually, I think he gets credited for inventing the dirty bird. I think he was the first guy to come up with that dance, and that slogan has followed the Falcons.
We would have preferred a Super Bowl trophy, but thanks for the dance, Jamal.
He got you almost there. He almost got you there.
Yeah, that's what counts.
We're going to go to break. When we come back, we're going to talk about the champions of NCAA last week and getting shot in the back. We'll talk about that and much more right after this quick break. Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. As we went to break, the beautiful and talented Michael Sam's first partner in Dancing with the Stars. But he wanted the lead, and she couldn't take that because, you know, she the boss in this world. Miss Erica Ash has slid into the building. Good morning to you.
Good morning, team.
Just to catch you up, let's show the picture of the lingerie Legends. They changed the name this year.
Okay.
That's the Atlanta Steam. I went to this game on Saturday night. Atlanta Steam versus the Chicago Bliss.
Wait,
this is lingerie football.
Those are not dudes.
No, those are women. Lingerie women. They're all women.
Okay.
Let's hope not.
Well, this is Atlanta.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. But to think that they've organized this well.
Give it a little time.
Bruce, 2018, it's coming.
Bruce Jenner and RuPaul going toe-to-toe.
Oh, my goodness.
I don't know. Have you ever? No? I can tell by your
lingerie
look.
Football?
Yes.
I've never played regular football.
Okay.
You ought to see this. It's brutal.
Give her a little taste of the action that she missed in this lingerie league, just to let her know that they. I went up there. They get real physical.
You went up there, for the show.
Yes. Oh, and you can drink. The players can get a beer.
They running over Erica.
Bam!
Get some of that. It's
absolutely
physical.
Ow! Ow!
Where do these women get that aggression from?
Abusive relationships. That's what I'm going with.
Oh, right. Like you're going to beat that chick up. She just knocked another human being off their feet. Right. And she's getting punched at home.
That's not a flag.
This is Fight Club. This is Fight Club.
That's the best part of it. None of that is a flag. You can do this to somebody all day long. There's no...
Wait.
They don't call flags.
The women can get punched and you don't get a flag?
Yeah, no flag.
It's finna be men signing up for this now. I'm like, yeah. I'm finna play for the Chicago Dynasty.
I'm sitting there talking to the ref. He's not paying attention. They don't call no fouls.
Heard of this. Look at him. He's serious about it, too.
Wait now. We just saw a clip. I can hit you in NFL football in the chest with my face mask and get a flag.
Correct.
But this woman just twerked on another woman's head.
She did.
She twerked on another woman's head,
she
and that wasn't.
And
that's
it
not
her
a
neck.
Foul.
And that was not a foul.
No.
Okay.
None of what you're seeing is a penalty. All this is legal.
Wow.
They only really call offsides. That's about all they call offsides. That's the only rule they got in the book.
We have two penalties on the field. We've got ripping the other player's ears off the side of her face and offsides. Hold on. Okay, we've only got offsides.
Just offsides. So we talked about that as she was going. You should go. I have to get you up to a game.
Where does this take place?
It's at the Gwinnett Center here. That's the Atlanta Steam against the Chicago Bliss. It's about 10, 12 teams in the league.
Wow.
Yes.
So different states.
It's about 15 players on each team. There's a team in Chicago. There's a team in L.A., Omaha here, and there's one in Jacksonville.
How many of these women have died? Because these injuries, you got to say, with the padding on and fully covered, is brutal.
Nobody died.
Wow.
Nobody died.
So does this prove that women are tougher than men? Because they play in less pads. They don't whine about the call.
Further proof, but yeah, sure, Kenny.
You missed that, and you also missed the soccer player for the Ottawa Fury on the plane from Canada. He got choked by the passenger next to him with the cord. It's funny what we can find to laugh about.
I can't tell you how many people I've wanted to choke on the plane. So it's just funny that, you know. So what was this passenger's reasons for choking him?
He said he had been mentioning that he felt like the soccer team was going to attack him. This is what the other guy.
So he was going to do them one by one?
So he reached over the seat with his phone cord and started choking the player.
Oh, he wasn't even sitting next to him. He was sitting behind him. Yes. So there was really no legitimate reason except his schizophrenia.
Well, I'm hoping that the man had
Is he on the no-fly list? I mean, what happens with him?
Yeah, do we get to at least put him on the no-fly list? I'm hoping that he's mentally disturbed because usually, from what I've heard, murder's the kind of crime you want to try and get away with. Uh-huh. And a plane is not exactly the place to kill somebody and then play coy. You know, like, no, I don't know nothing about the dude dead next to me with the cord around his neck that I'm got no, my you, fingerprints
all over.
What you
do is kill him and then prop him up with the pillow like he's sleep.
Like Weekend at Bernie's?
I saw Passenger 57.
Was the choker white? The guy who was strangling, was he white?
Yeah, they both gentlemen were white.
Okay. So they're both alive. Nobody got
shot, so that's
and then
This wasn't the Al Sharpton. It wasn't the Al Sharpton case.
And you know the people involved had to be white because black people can't afford to fly.
Yeah. So now you're all caught up.
I'm all caught up. Okay. Wow. I missed a very, very eventful morning.
Now, you know, we try to keep certain subjects, and since you're here, and we're kind of we'll deal with the NCAA in a second. I left here last week, and I know the producers over here, they're gonna get in all their panties in a bundle in a second. I go to CVS. I have to get my medication, and I'm sitting there in the chair. The lady says I can get it to you in 10 minutes, and I look over, and maybe a couple of months ago, I saw that CVS sells personal vibrators for women. Mm-hmm.
Oh.
I didn't know that until then. This is right with the lube and the condoms. Now, I would have brought this product.
Condoms has a D in it.
Now, for you people that I'm sitting there, I'm waiting. And, you know, when you're dealing with a lot of old people, they ask a lot of questions to the pharmacist. So you have to be patient. And I'm minding my own business, but I do have wandering eyes. I'm an information gatherer. And I see now they sell a product called Fresh Balls. Yes, Fresh Balls. I was going to buy something, but as I sat there, I kept thinking like that first time you go to buy some condoms as a little boy and you have that, they're going to know. I'm about to have sex. And I kept thinking, if I bought this Fresh Balls, she's going to think, because I just want to bring it here. But she's going to think I'm using the product. And that's the only reason I didn't actually buy the product. But I did go over and read it.
Fresh Balls. They have it up on the screen.
Oh, he has it up there.
It's
there
about
you go.
Time. They've been having Massengill and all manner of good products for us to keep our little caves fresh, but y'all get to come and slap around with your little stink balls all over the place. So thank goodness for Fresh Balls.
So fresh and so dry.
Go nuts over Fresh Balls.
go nuts over Fresh Balls, the product that you will always have to explain at the register. Hey, yeah, you know, this ain't really for me. I'm right. just getting it because I do a radio show. And when I go on the radio, I just want to show it because we got a video feed,
and
too.
That's what I felt like and I was going to have to do. So I didn't buy it. I was like, man, you know how what? Can I get this product?
You gotta just be gangster.
Because I go there all the time.
For my daddy.
And for my dad. For my dad.
For my daddy.
Hey, and let me tell you something, Erica, and for every other woman that's listening right now, the smell of taint on the balls is a flea that goes with the dog, okay? If a man's gonna whip his balls out, it ought to smell like balls. You don't want balls to smell like woodland fresh or chili lime salsa. What?
Okay, look but be it. Fair. Look if, you, if we gotta accept balls smelling like balls, then I don't think y'all need to expect us to be smelling like strawberries and cream down there. Okay, we need to be smelling like what we were born to smell like too. Fair. I'll take your tank, but you need to take whatever comes with my stuff, too.
Hey, look, as long as you're willing to put them together, it don't matter to me. We could smell like dumpster juice and fish market, and I'm still, let's
as
just.
As wise sage once stated, now,
to my audience, now you see why I have to keep some stuff to just.
Hey, I'm telling you, let's just.
I can't bring everything here, but I just had that.
Hey, let Febreze worry about it. Let's just freshen the air.
By a show of hands before we move on, did any of you know this product existed until I just won?
Wow.
One out of 200 people that are here.
Wow.
He would be the one.
That's all right.
Hey, okay.
Frodo Baggins would be the one.
I tell you what, I have a confession. I knew it existed, but I just refused to use it.
I just thought I should bring that to the public. To you men out there that's, you know, chafing and all that kind of stuff.
I'm awful glad you did. You know, I can recommend that to
the best thing you can do, let me give you some advice, is from a person that plays sports. What you need to do is go to CVS, get you a pair of cheap clippers, and shave yourself up. Get the hair out of the creases of your leg, because if you play sports like me, you had to, because you was always sweating. And all of you, especially you men, be trying to figure out why your balls have an odor. And it's because hair holds musk.
That's listen,
why
you,
does. That's yes, why you're, does.
That's it's why bacteria that gets yes. on the hair. And so, let
amen.
Me say,
you know, amen.
This is a public service announcement. That's what we're doing.
Thank you for
a
that.
A PSA.
Yes.
And this cosmetic product is the result of a guy who owns a cosmetic company getting a complaint from his woman about his stinky balls.
Hey, genius.
Genius. Genius. And now he'll make at least a couple dollars, but he won't get none of my money.
Yeah, and now he can divorce her because now he figured out why other women are running away.
Now he can go back and get with his true love.
Poor bikini wife.
But we're going to go to break.
She just got Febreze.
We're going to go to break. We'll be back with more Fresh Balls, Erica Ash, Big Ken, and the Sports Joc. 888-926-7562.
The Sports Joc Show is now on the gaming site Twitch. Play along while you watch at thesportsjoc.com. Click on your iPhone icon if you're mobile.
And now, back to the Sports Joc. Wayne Gandy.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. It is April the 13th. Get your taxes filed by Wednesday. For you people that already have gotten your refund check, I'm quite sure you spent it already. I need to get me. I've never got a refund check, but I guess that is a great feeling. Huh? Is that a great feeling to get a refund check? Like, you know, knowing some money is coming back. Get your taxes filed. Last week,
you guys file taxes.
Okay, Wesley Snipes.
Silly humans. No, I'm just, I make jokes, but I tell people all the time, don't think that them people have any charge it to the game in their system. There's no when once you get in bad with the IRS, they're gonna get their little cut.
Yes, they will.
They will get their cut. If they have to send you to jail for it, that's just what they'll do.
Interrupt your whole life. Last Monday, it's been a week since we have spoken to you. Duke won their fifth national title. Bad producer. I'm sorry, because your North Carolina's Tar Heels only have two. That goes out to him because he's a Duke hater. Mike Krzyzewski, five titles now in his tenure at Duke. UConn women, in more impressive fashion, won their 10th. Their third in a row. Their 10th overall. And I think that 10 is in the last 11 years. I mean, that's what kind of winning UConn women have been doing. Coach G up there is doing a great job. And we spoke about that last week, that if it was male, it would be they'd have T-shirts printed. We'd be walking around in UConn gear. But since it's female with that kind of record, we basically haven't seen this kind of winning from a team since John Wooden and the UCLA Luau Cinder days. Bill Walton and those guys. But 10, I think, and I want to say in like 15 years, they've won these 10 championships. Great team, UConn women. I'm quite sure they will be highly ranked next year as well. Seven players from Kentucky left. Basically, they only played eight, so seven of them left. As you know, the Kentucky Wildcats, who went 38-1, losing in the semifinals, the first undefeated team since UNLV to get that far and lose in the semifinal. And on a sad note, out of Mount St. Joseph University, 19-year-old Lauren Hill passed away. You know, all season we talked about her playing in a couple of games. In her effort to do that, she raised $1.5 million for cancer research. Mm-hmm. But she passed away. She had brain cancer. She knew she was going to pass at some point. I think the doctor originally gave her like 18 months. She lived a little longer than that. But she has passed away on a sad note.
And she raised $1.5 million. For cancer research.
Yes.
But somebody could put up a GoFundMe or a Kickstart for going to Vegas for fight weekend and get $3 million or something like that.
It's sad, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, and you know, there are people calling off work today because they're tired. And this woman played collegiate sports with brain cancer.
Yes, it was just
so. I hope that makes you feel better about your complaining and whining. Yeah. For those of you that are listening right now.
Yeah, $65 million for private jet so I can take food.
The
deep reaches of the world. That's why I'm going to take some food. Because, you know, they've been calling me.
Yeah,
even though they don't have no cell phone.
Right.
And told me that we're tired of this.
and this is something that I think is interesting is, how does a country with no food have a airport? I'm saying, if you can't afford lights, I mean, you burning candles in the house. How y'all got an airport that a private jet could land at?
Right.
That is true, isn't it?
Yeah.
Bobby Hurley took the job at Arizona State to be their new head coach. Wisconsin is losing junior Sam Decker to the draft. And Jahlil Okafor leaves Duke after 1 year, joining the likes of Kyrie Irving, Luol Deng, and Austin Powers to be only four or five people who ever have left Duke that soon. That's the NCAA. What else do we have? I think that's it. But Kenny, it was something else we were supposed to speak
with on. Seven of the eight that they played at Kentucky leaving, how does the eighth guy feel?
That he stayed.
Is he staying for moral reasons, or is it just like, oh man, my prospects don't look good?
Well, it's the little I forget his name right now, the shortest player that plays point guard. He's about 5'8". He's gonna have to kind of show him a little more with his height. The rest of them were all 6'10", 6'11", so they know.
Right.
They might, even if they don't get drafted high, they're gonna, when you're that tall, you're gonna get you a shot. When you're short, you're going to have to really kind of dazzle people to believe that you can overcome that, especially at the NBA level. Hillary Clinton, before we move on, y'all voting for Hillary? Anybody for Hillary? For president? No? All y'all are Democrats.
I am going to listen to what everyone has to say and
and vote based on the issues. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Now, I've traditionally voted for some Democratic candidates, but I have voted for a Republican in my time, although I'm not an elitist, separatist snob like the other Republicans that we have here, mediocre producer. You know, I just think each candidate should be judged on his merit. So,
absolutely.
You know, if Hillary's all for legalization of marijuana and
I was waiting on that
and prostitution, then I'll give her a look.
You too? Is that your outlook?
I just think if Hillary will pass a bill that states every man has to use fresh balls.
See, and that's when I'm going independent. I'm just...
and the Boston bomber suspect in a case that really actually happened 2 years this Wednesday would be the second anniversary of the Boston Marathon bombing. He was found guilty on all 30 counts, and he's waiting on sentencing, which will be either life in prison or the death penalty. Wow. I don't know why they went to court. His basis.
Just saved everybody some time and just shot him in the street right there. That's what they do nowadays.
Yeah, I figured they could have knocked him on off and saved us 2 years of all this litigation.
And tax money.
The Boston Marathon this year is next Monday. They'll be running the Boston Marathon, but this gentleman definitely... 3 people dead, 260 injured at the finish line of the Boston Marathon back in 2013. For you people that's been living under a rock and don't know the case, his older brother, Tamarick or something like that.
Tamerlan.
Tamerlan. He was shot in the shootout. And Darsar, how you say his name?
Yokar.
Yokar. You know, they got a lot of vowels, no consonants.
Yokar,
you
know, so nice. His traditional Ukrainian name is Yokar.
Yokar.
He's very famous, fought in Spanish-American and Ukrainian war.
His whole case, he's 21 now. He was 19 when the incident happened. His case was that his brother manipulated him into the whole, let's go set some bombs off at the finish line.
It's funny how times have changed. I remember when my older siblings used to manipulate me into like putting firecrackers in ant holes.
Now, but see, it's a gateway. You start off with the firecrackers in the anthole.
Yeah.
Little did he know when he was little, you know what I mean? Yeah. Tamerlan, come let me show you something, Yokar. Come watch the blow the hole up in the ants. And okay, you remember the game we used to play as kids? I have new game for you. And then you take this backpack. Where am I going?
It does not
matter. Just go with
that
backpack.
Terrible.
Sit down in crowd and then run. It's funny. I trust
you. Yeah, it's gonna be funny locked up for.
You don't think he'll get the death penalty?
I think he should get the death.
I definitely think I think that he should definitely be locked up for life. The only reason why I would not say the death penalty is because I think that he needs, for me, the death penalty sometimes is too easy.
Mm-hmm.
When someone has to live with what they've done and the fact that they'll never get out of prison, for me, that's the worst punishment.
I think that the death penalty would probably embolden those that he supports and that support him. The terrorists, the rebels would see him as some sort of martyr. I'm sure they already see his brother as a martyr. And now the system that they were fighting against has killed yet another one of their soldiers. So this will only incite more people to go out and do what it is he's accused of doing. So sitting in prison, like she said, in that restricted 23 hours a day in a box, 1 hour out in a cage, you know what I mean, basically, would be the kind of life that you've got to pay for what you did day for day, hour for hour for the next. And, you know, he's only in his 20s now, so he could be in jail for 60 years.
I like to put him to sleep myself. If it was the Shawshank days when prisons was like that, then yes. But
you mean prisons where they got old Andy?
But now you basically will be in a locked up. You know, you can write some memoirs and sell a book. You can get fresh fruit, that kind of stuff.
Wait, they got fruit? Although you don't want the and bananas and prunes.
I watched Orange is the New Black. I didn't see no fresh fruit.
They don't have fresh fruit in the Fed?
You don't want to find a banana on the pillow. You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't want to get caught with fresh fruit. Just like, it's so good. And they be looking at you like, you like them strawberries, boy? Like, yeah, they good. They real good. I picked them myself. Thank you so much. I didn't know they had fresh fruit. Yeah, they got tossed salad, too. Excuse me?
I just don't want it. Just let them go to bed. Put them to sleep. Put them in the grave. And, you know, I think it's something so pleasant and so American, like a marathon, where nobody's out here to do nothing but run, mm-hmm. and you're out here blowing people up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's one thing maybe in a dark night,
Mardi Gras is okay.
Yeah, with some drunks. But to blow up just some innocent people standing there with their kids and for that, kill him. I'm for it. Wayne Gandy for president. Be back. 888-926-7562 with more of the Sports Joc Show right after this.
The Sports Joc Show is coming to the Southern Radio Network this spring. Alabama, Mississippi, and Southern Georgia, get ready. Watch at thesportsjoc.com. Click on the iPhone icon if you're mobile.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. The Masters Tournament is over. The 79th Masters Tournament down in Augusta National. Young winner, 21-year-old Jordan Spieth, has won the Masters, tying Tiger Woods for the lowest score ever in a Masters Tournament. First time since 1976 that someone has led each round at the Masters, which is an achievement in itself. I still need to get down there and get the contact number to the man that keeps the azaleas. Just beautiful landscape. Have you ever gone down there? Even the pictures you see on TV, the lawn, and that might be better than the golf to me. I'm a big yard man, but I think I don't know what they're spraying on there. Probably that stuff that Big Kenny uses on his marijuana. But the azaleas down there are just tall and gorgeous.
The azaleas are actually just camouflage for a marijuana growing distribution thing we got going on in Augusta. So,
I think golf with Tiger Woods fading to black is going to need a young star, especially in this country. As we have reported over the last two or three years, a lot of golf courses have closed. It seems that fever for the average avid golfer has faded. You know, it was a period there where everybody, the whole conversation was, what was your handicap and all that kind of stuff. You don't really get into a lot of those conversations anymore. And I think some of that surrounds Tiger Woods. Mm-hmm. Falling off. You look at that decline that has been in this 5-6 year window since that car accident, and his wife attacked him with the golf club, and the multiple porn ladies that he seemed to have been hiring, or at least dealing with. I think he was just dealing with, because he wasn't
polite.
Paying them, right?
Multiple porn ladies. That's
yes.
Polite.
That's what.
<They're polite. laughs> You can call those.
Tiger Woods was playing better. He did make the cut. He got frustrated one time down on the 13th hole. Big Kenny, Erica, he was throwing his club. Let's see, Tiger all takes him a good old swing. We couldn't play it because Tiger, if you don't know, kind of has foul mouth. So he was cursing, but that's Tiger. He has that look on his face, just that it was, you son of a. You can just interpret that look, can't you, Big Kenny?
I don't know why Tiger acts mad.
What is that look right there? What is that look?
Yeah, F.
That's that I could have still been with them strippers last night. You know, why am I even out here? This is.
He came in 17th. He did make the cut. He was up at 9 or 10 there going into Sunday, and then things kind of fell apart. At one point, he even hurt his wrist on a swing. But I think it was a good outing for him. It's been a long time that he's even been in contention for a minute. He's been so bad here of late, but
I like that. It's a good outing.
It's a good outing.
Yeah, take my grandmother on outings. He's trying to say he's gotten too old for the game.
Yeah, it fades. Yeah. It fades.
Yeah, it does.
I think that people sometimes never realize you have your real big moment.
And the best thing to do is bow out at the right time, and Michael Jordan.
You just hope
bow
that.
Bow out at the right time. Even if you get back in, you just bow out at the right time. So at least you could say, I had this one retirement. That was.
But I think right now he's, a lot of us are just hoping he wins one more.
Yeah.
It seems like it would just be sweet to see him. He climbed the mountain, he fell off the mountain, and I think we all just want to see
end on a high note.
End on a high note, and then he can go with a snow bunny, and literally a snow bunny, though. So you see, no, it's literally a snow bunny.
Because she skis.
Because she skis. Right, it's not one of those. I'm not trying.
It ain't just because she a white girl.
Yeah,
he's not racist.
I'm not trying to be hip.
Listen,
mediocre producer. It's a snow bunny. Do you know what a snow bunny is anyway?
I've never had sex with women outside of my
mediocre producer.
Listen.
Yeah, he used to be the good producer, and then he's mediocre. He's almost down to bad producer, but
this
bad producer has that so locked up it can't even get him down there.
It'd have to be a contest. This is what I don't understand. So you just said, everybody wants to see him climb the mountain again. Do you think a lot of what Tiger is going through right now is because he's unable to just accept the fact that people are going to have to feel how they feel about his state of health and where he is in the game right now? A lot of these players keep playing, hoping for that moment. You know what I mean? It's like I've seen comedians get on stage and they have a really good set, and then their last joke doesn't hit like they want it to hit. And so they stay on stage an extra 7 minutes hoping for that roar of laughter that never really comes, and now you've taken what was a really good set and kind of made it blah. So he's taken what was a phenomenal career, and now he's tainting it with all of this dropping out of. And now to go from unranked or 111th up to 17th is, to me, a win.
Mm-hmm.
So you prove that you still got some scrap in you, Tiger.
Mm-hmm.
We know you ain't no punk. We know that you love the game. Go ahead and do something else.
Well, and that's the thing. 95% of the people that play golf hope to just do what Tiger's doing in these losses.
Right.
They don't even get that high.
Right.
They wish they could end up ninth on the leaderboard.
Yeah.
Him being ninth on the leaderboard is a failure. I think that it seems to me that Tiger Woods did not fully understand how on a pedestal people had him. I think he thought it was just on the golf side.
Mm-hmm.
When it turned out that people actually had, like, he was
the
president.
Yeah.
That it wasn't just golf. I'm not just like the other, because other athletes, some kind of marital scandal is part of the gig.
Mm-hmm.
You don't sit there, beast mode, cheat on his wife. Yeah, that's what I thought. Yeah. He was smoking with the chick. I saw last night.
So y'all don't want to get tacos? That's what I'm saying. But everybody was like, no, Tiger.
But when Tiger did it, I don't think he knew that everybody had him. No, not just on the golf course.
Right.
We're actually seeing you as, in a sense, royalty. Your whole life is what I want to pattern myself out.
Well, see, also, not only did we see him as royalty, but when he had his fall, all of the things that fell out of the closet, you know, yes, I have cheated on my wife with her and her and her.
Right. What about me?
And those two. Oh, I forgot about you. Hey, baby. And her. And then there's them. And there's a few more here. You know what I mean? And everybody was like, not
and
only.
And the co-check girl.
Right, co-check girl. And I'm sure there was a broad who was doing my makeup early. I probably hit her. You know, and so now everybody's, not only are you a philanderer, but you're a serial cheater. You're just, you're a fraud. Everybody, we thought you were. But that was our fault. For you to look at someone and idolize him so much that you start giving your kids advice based on what Tiger would do.
Right.
Well, you know what I mean? That's your fault.
And that's his profession, because golf has always been the gentleman's game.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. When you look at other sports, you're supposed to be a criminal if you play football.
Philanderer.
You're supposed to have multiple women and do drugs if you're a basketball player. A baseball player, you're supposed to beat your wife. And,
not all of them do. Let's just say that for the record.
No, I'm talking about the image that with these sports, you know, Floyd, boxer.
That is definitely the stereotype.
A boxer is supposed to be like Floyd Mayweather.
Mm-hmm.
He's, you know, so, but in golf, you're, you're prestigious. You don't do those kind of things. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't take ice with your water. Mm-hmm. You want lime and lemon with your halibut.
Mm-hmm. That's what gentlemen do. Gentlemen have mistresses. Golf is a gentleman's game. That's what gentlemen do. They drink scotch. They have mistresses.
Clubs that they go to right after the game is just full of all these women that Tiger seems to be engaging with.
Yeah, he's only supposed to be cheating with his PR girl.
Right.
He's supposed to hire him a PR woman, and that's who's supposed to be your mistress undercover.
But her job was a little bit too high because he likes sort of the nannies. He likes the chick on fries. Right. He likes the, you know, lettuce washer.
That
he
treats him dirty, like Tiger. He wants to be treated like a tiger. Yeah.
But I think part of what the backlash was Tiger exposed golf's dirty little secret, is that we're like other athletes. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We do the same things that other athletes do, and now people know that because the best of us is doing it. Our king, our crowned king, is doing it. So now you know the dude that's ranked 23rd is trying to step out and do some of that too. So I don't know.
You know Jack Nicklaus and Arnold Palmer. These people was 20 in the 60s.
Right.
Free love. And, you know, they were in the back of the van.
Right.
With a little some peyote or what do y'all call it?
Yeah. They had peyote.
But
in the 60s, part of that, though, in the 60s, the image of golf didn't really go with the image of free love because those were hippie types and golf was more the clean cut, you know, button down, polo shirt set. So, but I'm sure they were still smashing all these different chicks.
Because, you know, we would all be surprised. Tiger pull up to the red light in his Cadillac or his Buick. He let the window down. 2 Chainz! You would be surprised.
Right.
And Tiger Woods listening to some 2 Chainz? Some Fetty Wap? Tiger? Not Tiger. That must be Tiger's brother. Because Tiger Woods listens to Frank Sinatra. Miles Davis.
You would hope.
That's what you look at. Dave Matthews.
Yeah.
So I think that's what, to me, I don't even think he knew that's where we had him as a public.
Yeah.
Now, I know he's an athlete. I know he competes in the way he, so it didn't shock me. Mm-hmm. But I really believe that he didn't really understand that. No, we believe you really are enjoying driving that Buick. You would never drop the top and go 200 in that Aston Martin. That's not you, Tiger. Mm-hmm. But we all, the three of us know that he's just a man, you know.
Right.
And all men succumb to certain things.
Right.
You know, so. Just like when people were surprised Michael Jordan gambled. Really?
Yeah.
That was
everybody's
a big story.
Something. I feel like golf is kind of like the preacher of sports.
Yeah, we'll be back. More of the Sports Joc Show. Big Kenny, Miss Erica Ash, right after this.
The Wayne Gandy Football Camp turns 20 this year, coming to Haines City, Florida, April 25th. Over the past 20 years, participants have included Warwick Dunn, Hines Ward, and Roddy White, just to name a few. Call Andrew Williams for more info at 863-221-9190.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. It is April 13th. It is Monday morning. It's 10 a.m. If you're just tuning in. You missed Fresh Balls. That was on deck earlier in the show. We would go back, but ain't no need of going back to some balls. We had people getting strangled on a flight. We also talked a little Tiger Woods and how UConn women's get no love when their 10th title last week. One thing over there, Massengill, was the funky white boy the DJ, because he keeps saying, who is play that funky music?
Singing.
Oh, the guy singing is also playing the funky music?
Yes, he was white.
Oh, okay. I never knew who was he telling the, was he in the stand? Yeah, we'll get it straight later, funky white boy. I used to hear that when I was like two. That's when I was two, it came out when I was two. I'm glad their mics are off over there because they would have been like, 2000 BC. That's what, you know, that's the local joke around here. But one of my good friends has just stepped into the studio. We're going to welcome him to the show in just a minute. My mediocre producer has given me his bio and gave me his whole name. I'm trying to figure out why he never told me his whole name. You know, he has a pimp name, too. Dimitri Giovanni Holiday. I mean, I see why you go by Vonnie. He's too muscular for Giovanni. You just can't tell when you're 6'5", 290, cut up. You can't be walking around talking about I'm Giovanni. You have to go by Vonnie, because that makes him sound hard, criminal-based. Vonnie Holiday. But my man Vonnie Holiday is here in the studio. This is where I'm supposed to act like nobody's in here but me and the two producers, and these other criminals aren't around me right now. Vonnie, if you don't know, this is our new stripper, Miss Erica Ash. She works the Satellite Stage 3 at Cheetah. Why did he laugh? Every Wednesday from 11 to 5. To her left is Smoke 3. Smoke 1 is Le'Veon Bell. Smoke 2 is LeGarrette Blunt. This is Smoke 3 right over there, Vic Kenny. But good morning to Vonnie Holiday. Can we get another round of applause to my...
When you said she stripped, he started laughing.
Why is that?
And she was like, why is he laughing? He gave her that. No one would pay you.
He gave a head throwback laugh.
No wonder she's doing radio.
Can we turn this mic on, please? Thank you. Mike, hold on.
I need to stand up. He hadn't seen my gifts. That's what it is.
Your gifts?
My gifts.
Hey, we ain't seen your gifts yet. I mean, go and unwrap them then.
Because I really was mad how they cut away from you in the bathroom. I thought you was going to live on the edge like Holly Berry.
No, I'm not ready for my Oscar yet.
I'm sorry, Bunny. I try to find better help, but these guys keep showing up.
Is that us? There we go. No disrespect. Not that you could not be a stripper. I mean, I would go down to Cheetah on Wednesday if I had free time and come see you.
So what he's saying is you can get a couple dollars for it. You know what I mean?
Thanks, Big Kenny.
Well, let me introduce you, both of you. Vonnie Holiday, first round pick, 1998. Played in the league 15, 16 years. He was a Playboy model. In 99, he did a spread with Jill Scott back in...
Was Jill Scott even out back in
1998? He went to UNC. So the first question, I'll let you ask him, did he go to class? You know, they make classes up at UNC.
Auburn?
Yeah, we known to be crooked. I mean, I accept that.
You're right.
Not only did he go to the class, he designed it himself.
And Vonnie, this is Miss Erica Ash. She is a classical ballerina. She has also been on Broadway in The Lion King. Most recently, she has been on Hollywood Husbands and Survivor's Remorse, where she plays our favorite character of a lesbian. On there in that new show, and she's in town filming that right now for you people that have stars. Add that to your package, my mother. You got 10 days before I come home. You better get that cable on.
Come on, mama.
Tired of coming there watching them two stations, and then you be mad why I don't come home more because you don't turn on the air conditioner and you don't have two stations on your TV.
Okay,
spam a lot. Yeah, yeah.
Well, Tiger.
Every time I go home, I ask, what happened to the cable? Well, you know, I only watch.
You want me to come? Do you want me to come?
Hey, that's better than my mom. My mom has all the channels because I pay for them. She has everything. I would trade with you anytime.
No, my mom likes to give the money to the casino. But we'll talk about that after the show.
Oh,
you know,
Lord.
I mean, mothers and all that. Well, Philip Buchanan said his mom tried to charge him $1 million when he got to league. She said he owed her $1 million. He's a cornerback out of Miami for raising him.
Wow.
As soon as he signed his contract, he's writing a tell-all book or something about it, what I thought was interesting.
Well, let me apologize to my mom right now for giving you a hard time.
and you complaining that your mom got all the channels. Your mom only got two. My mom opens the curtains and watches people get robbed for entertainment. Okay. That's what's going on. She watches the homeless guys freeze to death for her entertainment. So,
but Vonnie, thank you for coming in and helping us with the show.
Thanks for having me. You were talking about my name earlier, Dimitri Giovanni. When you're a big 6'3" at the time, 6'4" black guy coming out of South Carolina, a little small town, you cannot go by Dimitri Giovanni. I mean, you would get laughed out of the classroom. And so, I was that kid that got to school early to go talk to the teacher to let her know, do not call my full name in class. I go by Vonnie. So just
Vonnie's way more manly. You know what I
mean? Vonnie. At the time, I didn't know. You know,
Dimitri sounds almost like one of those Italian gangsters.
Like I can't believe it's
Italian.
Yeah. Like, right. Name, I think of like a long-haired white boy who holds a butter tub.
You didn't realize that it affected women like that till you got older. You
until
know what I mean?
Until I got to college.
Right.
Giovanni. So now you let them call you Dimitri?
I will. Okay. I will. I still go by Vonnie.
I think
but
your name is sexy.
Thank you. I do now. Personally. Hey, I do now.
Hey, look, she's still trying to get that stripper money.
Hey, this is not one of those shows.
You're not trying to make a little
matchmaker and The Bachelor and all that stuff.
Sorry, your name sucks. How about that? I can't compliment the man on his name.
And don't let the sports jock tell you that they don't have love connections on this show. If I told you the number of, I'm gonna let that go.
Well, I want to look for one anyway. He got a ring on it.
Yeah, I'm rocked up. You know.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. He does have a ring on.
Yeah. That's the first thing I peeped.
I forgot to tell people that when they asked me about it. I missed that part. No, I'm messing with you.
He said, I'm rocked up and all the drug heads got excited. Like, well, hold on. He rocked up. We're going to get some.
Well, Vonnie, Troy Polamalu, retiring. Greatest safety ever? I had this debate in the barbershop.
He is absolutely up in the top, I think, three. I don't know if he's the greatest ever. I mean, he played the game. He reminded me, and a lot of people might not remember this guy, but Leroy Butler of the Green Bay Packers, I think evolutionized the safety playing in the box, being so effective in the run game, really mixing it up. Troy Polamalu was a guy with great instincts, tremendous speed, just the cerebral part of his game, people underestimate that. His ability to adjust on the fly and to sometimes just on a gut, just go make a play. Mm. I mean, it drives defensive coordinators crazy, but when you make the play, you know, everybody's applauding you and excited about it. And that's what he was able to do. I talked to guys who played with him who said, you know, he was supposed to be back covering the deep third, and all of a sudden he's in the box making a tackle for a loss or sacking the quarterback.
I think that was one thing when I watched him play, he had in common with Junior Seau. They were one of those players that even when I go to block Junior, he broke all the rules because it's like, well, he can't go in here because he has contained. There's no way he's going to go in this A-gap because there won't be anybody out here to make the play. He goes in the A-gap. He makes the play. I'm quite sure the coordinator is over there like, no, yes, yes. That's going to help me get a head coaching job, even though I didn't call that play. But Polamalu, 12 years in the league, 8-time Pro Bowler. If you know anything about the Pittsburgh defense, it's centered around – that safety position that he plays and the linebacker play, it always has been. You just never knew it. And he played that position to a T. I thought 2 years ago he probably would retire. He came back, you know, bought him some more of that. What commercial he does for that hair? Pert. Is it Pert?
It's not Head and Shoulders?
Well, I haven't used
it. I think it's Head and Shoulders. Yeah.
Is it Head and Shoulders?
Yeah. Is it Head and Shoulders?
Yeah.
What did I say?
Pert.
It's a
shampoo.
Shampoo, right?
Yeah,
I'm the wrong person to ask about shampoo.
That's the Pert shampoo with Tussin.
I haven't washed my hair since 81.
Fair enough.
It goes with the rag. Everything just gets washed with that same old rag.
That's about the last time they made a bottle of Pert.
I'm the same way, man.
Yeah, it's the same rag. You just keep wiping it.
And she's saying that Pert isn't made anymore, and I'm sitting over here like, they don't sell it anymore? Maybe that's why I can't find it on the shelf.
You used to use Cornhuskers lotion, too.
You know I did. That's why I got them silky smooth heels now.
Yeah, you ain't need any lotion in Florida. Yeah. You don't need lotion at all. We didn't buy lotion. Yeah, just walk outside, you lather up,
yeah.
And you're good.
I may have been the only guy in Florida to buy lotion. I had cocoa butter. And the time you walk outside, it was time to take a shower again. I would walk into a restaurant, sit at a bar to eat, and the lady, man, you smell like chocolate.
You've been baking.
Well, when you got guns like that, you have to cocoa butter them up.
Is that what it is?
Hey, hey, this ain't that kind of show. This is
kind of show. No.
Remember, you already said.
Hey, I don't get to make a love connection. You don't get to make a love connection either.
Hey, I'm Brittany Griner, and I'm gay. We're going to go to break.
Gee, Brittany, we didn't know that.
We're going to go to break when we come back. Speaking of gay, Michael Sam got voted off of. I can't say that. That's wrong, too. But he said he was, though. Oh, okay. 888-926-7562. We'll talk about the guy that got kicked off of Dancing with the Stars when we come back. Mr. Vonnie Holiday, Vic Kenny, Miss Erica Ash, right after this.
The 20th annual Wayne Gandy Football Camp is coming to Haines City, Florida, featuring hometown hero Wayne Gandy. This free football camp is for kids aged 5 to 16 and includes a cheerleading camp featuring Cheer Girl Entertainment cheerleaders, free t-shirts, and lunch for all participants. Your kids will get instruction from NFL stars, autograph sessions, and more. To register your child, call Andrew Williams at 863-221-9190.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. We left you. We were talking about Michael Sam. I found out I can't group him in. He probably would like that.
Group in gay. Group him in. Group him in with the gay guys.
Michael Sam, as you know, the former Missouri Tiger. That's the only title I'll give him. All that former NFL. He never been no NFL. He did get cut off of Dancing with the Stars. I guess his buns, as they said, didn't keep him on the show. We have his exit. Is that him? He bleached his skin? Oh, no, there he is.
Michael and Peter.
You had a chance, Michael, to share your story, share your message. What did you get out of this experience?
It was an awesome experience. I mean, please give my partner Peter everything. She was amazing. I had a great time, an awesome experience. I want to thank Dance with the Stars. I want to thank everyone here to come out and support. It was awesome. Had fun.
That's Michael Sam being voted off of Dancing with the Stars.
Wait, I got a question. So we can't say gay, but his partner can be named Peter. where is this country going? I mean, what I'm saying, the man has got his boot on our neck, and he's missing all of this most important information. We wasting time with words like gay. Just let us say that, because if he can partner with a Peter, we can say gay.
I think if he can do any of those exploits, like I said, he should go do a show on Bravo with EJ Johnson. To the hard way.
What is the politically
correct
term now? That's
what they should call it. To the hard way.
I mean, what do you say?
LGBT, right? Is that what you say?
Everybody got to be categorized into everything. That's the
thing. Sounds like a sandwich. Let me get that LGBT extra meat, okay?
I messed the letters up. Is that right? LGBT?
Yeah, they definitely say that.
I'm going to need that foot long, no, okay?
He must have been a terrible dancer.
Listen,
because the community's strong. I mean,
they're supposed to be a rhythmic people. That's what I'm saying. They're supposed to be a rhythmic people. And I know that they're a strong community. They support one another, as Vonnie was saying. So right. I know they was all on the phone like, do that, do, 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 do. We going to vote for you. And right. Then for them to turn their backs on him. But the MTV Awards did come on. So maybe they were all looking for Amber Rose or something. I don't know.
Well, Michael Sams has been voted out the NFL. As you know, a couple of weeks ago, he went out for the veteran tryouts. He ran a slower time a year later. What can you say to get America to accept that Michael Sam is not on par with other NFL talent? I keep trying to get people to understand that you can't play defensive end running a 5-1. It's just not. Who are you going to catch?
I mean, you're absolutely right. And the problem is, and people get caught up in how someone played in college. He was the SEC Defensive Player of the Year 1 year. And, okay, that's great. But how many guys go from college and can't make the transition to the NFL? Hundreds every year. It happens all the time. And Michael Sam is no exception. Great story. Yeah, a great story. But, unfortunately, he didn't have what it takes to be an NFL player. I mean, you're talking about the elite guys in football. There's only, what, 1,900 jobs?
Yes.
How many schools are out there? There's thousands and thousands of players coming out auditioning for these jobs every year. and you have the guys that are already in the league, and then you got the guys that are trying to come in. I mean, just, the numbers just didn't work out for him, and he doesn't have the talent. He just doesn't have the talent.
And that's all I've been trying to get people. It has nothing to do with his sexuality. It has nothing to do with anything that it doesn't transfer. No, what you do in college, you see it in even in all sports. That guys you've never heard of. Who heard of James Harden? Yeah. Nobody heard of James Harden, but you know his name now. I mean, when he dropped that 35 on you every night, but you know, we didn't know about him. And I'm quite sure it was a ton of guys drafted before him, but you knew of. And now, because it is another level, and everybody, just like Tim Tebow, and you can go on and on from Charlie Ward, who won the Heisman when I was coming out,
right,
who accepted, I won't be able to make it, so I'm going to go play basketball.
Right.
The same thing with Michael Sam. Because you was a defensive player of the year in college doesn't make you an NFL star. Big Kenny.
I wonder, how is it that you get not picked up by a team in the rookie draft and then go to the veterans draft? I mean, how do you try out as a veteran when you didn't make it as a rookie? How does he even qualify as a veteran?
I think they just – it was another open trial that the NFLPA and with him being labeled gay,
right,
they're not going to try to put in any kind of fight to say he can't do it, because they're going to say – oh, he should get special treatment, right, or, you know, this is what we're talking about with the NFL. And right, I keep trying to tell you, the NFL, for a long period of time, they don't care. As long as you were not actually convicted. This is the new NFL. Think about it. So you can still do stuff. The old NFL, yes, guys. And, I mean, the guy who was on my team was convicted of being a drug kingpin. Right. He still played that whole season while he was on trial. I mean, they don't care about that kind of stuff. So,
no, we have a great justice system. No, I'm just saying. We got the greatest justice system in the world. When you can sit up there like, yeah, I'll be moving them packs. All right, do dope boy sweep on three. You know what I mean? Just, everybody knows what's coming. And it's just, I don't know. But the whole Michael Sam's thing, man, I think a lot of what is going on with him is in an effort to popularize the story of overcoming prejudice against sexual preference or sexual orientation. And they need another poster person now, because all of his little efforts are starting to dry up.
Well, yes. Well, the NFL is about that green. They're about money. They don't care what color you are. They don't care what, you know, what you did off the field. If you're, like you said, if you're not convicted, you're going to go out and you can make plays. You can run that ball and find the hole and gain yards and score touchdowns. That's all that matters. And with you were talking about Michael Sam's. I mean, that veteran combine, it's a new deal. It's great for veteran players, but at the same time, it's about that media is driven. It's about money.
Right.
So bringing that story in adds a new element, more viewership. I mean, they're smart.
Right.
That's the whole thing.
NFL being in the meeting room like, all right, this is what we're going to do. We're going to get the old dudes and the Tinkerbells together, and we're going to let them compete. And what I'm saying now, you had a little Tinkerbells in them pink shoes, and the old dudes will be on that Metamucil. It's going to be good TV. It's going to be good TV, man. Think 24-hour news cycle.
Yeah, the NFL will always be – they will only change when you complain. The rules they put in place, now they run the campaign with the domestic violence. If you had never said anything, they were never going to put some kind of charter that said you got to be thrown out.
I mean, that's the same way it is with most sports. Think about basketball and the guy with, you know, the whole nappy-headed hose thing. That wasn't the first time he said that, you know. Every sport is like that. Every career period is like that. Politicians, preachers.
But maybe something good can come out of some of these missteps, because when Don Imus called the Rutgers girls basketball team nappy head hoes, the next time you saw them on film, they was laid. You see what I'm saying? All of them had the butter. Am I lying? No. They all were laid down. Hair on fleek. Hair was on fleek.
They even got that baby hair.
They had everything laid down. Everybody was looking.
The little baby hair.
They were professionally coiffed.
On Saturday, no bigger name in the league right now. Johnny Manziel let out of rehab after 10 weeks. Is this a true issue for Johnny, you think? Alcoholism or whatever he went in there for? Nobody knows really what he went to rehab for. This is something the Browns, you feel, put on him, or Roger Goodell, Or you think Johnny really raised his hand like, yeah, I got a problem?
I think Johnny's a young guy. And so for him to say, yeah, I have a problem, I don't think that's how it happened. I think it was maybe more of an intervention with his family, the Browns organization, saying, hey, look, we draft you. We want you to be our guy, and you're squandering this opportunity. I mean, you're going to let us look back on this. You let yourself down. You let your family down. It's time to rein this in and get this, you know, get it together. I was sitting there watching the news with my wife and my kids, and it came across the bottom of the screen, Johnny Manziel out of rehab, and show how long he's been there. My wife's like, what the hell? I mean, why would you go to rehab for so long? I mean, that was a long time to be there. Most people go to rehab for a week or two. They say, hey, I'm good. Let me back out. And then you have a relapse, and then you go back for another 2 weeks. But he's been in there for 10 weeks.
Yes.
So hopefully he's cured. I don't know if he was in there just vacationing.
He's not cured. He got out yesterday, called me like 20 minutes later, and was like, roll up. I was like, you know what it is. And you know what I'm saying? And we went to go see Michael Sam's dance. It was just what we do.
I was thinking the same thing. 10 weeks is a – what are you in here for? I thought it was a 40-day thing.
That's a long time.
You've been in there since January 20th or something. Like, that's a long time. Be in any
but it could be really, really comfortable in there. So, you know, he probably stayed for the spa aspect.
But those are those severe addiction issues when you have to stay past the 4 weeks that they generally ask a person to stay for observation and rehabilitation. So maybe Johnny just wanted to save his job because somebody was like, bro, you're going to end up like Tim Tebow. And he was like, oh, I need to do something. But just saying I'm sorry wouldn't work, you know, because he's done so much. He can't just go, hey, man, and I'll be tripping. Because
he's basically spent the whole offseason. Yes. I mean, it's time to go. It's, you know, a lot of NFL teams go back to their spring camps and things like that this month. So he spent all that time. I don't know if he's working out or what state.
in rehab.
Do you work out in rehab?
It's a lot of time. Yeah.
They got light weights, though, because, you know, drug addicts be thin. He ain't in there throwing up 350 off his chest or nothing like that.
But he is out. Hopefully this time around. He's only been in the league 1 year.
But there was nothing specified. So what? He had all the addictions. I mean, was he addicted to everything?
I think it was just fame. I think that we don't want to take credit as the media and realize that you're going into these college campuses and you're putting 18, 19 year olds into fame and they're losing their way. It's like a child actor. We've seen how many examples of how they just can't handle it.
Brittany, because, Lindsay.
Yeah,
it's fame on steroids now with social media. Yeah,
social
and
media
all
has
that.
Changed the game. I'm glad that wasn't out when I was coming through.
Social media has allowed regular people who have not actually worked to get the fame that these.
And so just imagine a guy that's famous actually being famous.
We're going to go to break and come back. More Vonnie Holiday, Big Kenny, Miss Erica, Lesbian Ash, and the Sports Joc right after this. No.
The Sports Joc Show is now on the gaming site Twitch. Play along while you watch at thesportsjoc.com. Click on the iPhone icon if you're mobile.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. I'm sitting here with NFL defensive tackle. Man, we used to have to block Bunny. You know, it's always funny trying to when you play against your friend, though. You know, because at least that first play is like, that's my boy. And then he'll mess around and make a play on you. Oh, it's like that? Oh, it's going to be like that? Yeah. You're going to make plays on me? Okay, okay. Because you be, and then it goes away.
I always wonder about that. When y'all are on the field and y'all, you know.
It just lasts one, other. Just one play.
But I'm saying, but do you are you in each other's ears? Like, no, nigga, give me this one. I want this one.
No, I think that the only thing I won't try to maybe do something that could hurt him would be the only thing for somebody that's a friend. And I know, well, I'm going to try to jump on the back of his legs.
Which offensive linemen do, which is a problem.
I'll let him go because he's my boy.
Ah.
I'm not friends with a whole lot of offensive linemen just because of that.
Gotcha.
But everybody else getting a torn ACL. We ripping that meniscus up.
Yeah, I'm trying to get on the back of his legs.
Right.
Miss Erica Ash and Big Kenny, we're all sitting here. Real quickly, Le'Veon Bell, as I said, for the Steelers. 3-game suspension for the incident last year when he got pulled over and didn't know that DUI had nothing to do with he thought it was alcohol. He didn't know you could get pulled over from marijuana. In that car also was LeGarrette Blount. He only got a 1-game suspension. Former cornerback Will Allen is being investigated. He's a $31 million Ponzi scheme that him and some of his business partners are in. So it'd be interesting to see how that goes.
Did you say billion?
No, 31 million.
Yeah, I mean, that don't make it no better. I'm just saying that's still, I was thinking like, whoa, that is, that's some serious time.
And Aaron Hernandez, somebody facing serious time. Have they come out with the verdict on that yet?
That dude's getting off.
You think so?
Oh, man,
I was just about to ask y'all.
When they deliberate that long, it's about to be a hung jury. It's about to be some sort of mistrial.
Somebody in there don't believe.
Somebody in there is not convinced that this man needs to go to jail.
Is that because he's a patriot?
Well, it may be because he's a patriot. It may be because he has some serious gang ties that makes it difficult for people to feel comfortable sending him to prison. You know, they just banned a reporter from the Boston area from covering the trial because he was following jurors to their cars and getting their license plates on film. And, you know, Aaron Hernandez is said to have he's also in trouble for a double murder in the Massachusetts area that was related to some witnesses testifying against him in another trial. So a lot of people may just be on some, hey, it ain't that serious for me. You know what I mean? He can take his chances with life, but I'm not going to take my chances with him and his connections.
I got kids.
And I think that probably the biggest thing, Vonnie, is Big Kenny, Erica, when you look at the case, there is no murder weapon. There's no eyewitness. And the only people are testifying are other criminals. Why would I trust what you're saying? They're trying to get off of their case. Yeah. The girlfriend or the girlfriend's sister, she took some plea deal. I mean, everybody seems to be probably in on this. And why, as a juror, do I believe any of you enough to put Aaron Hernandez when I don't have a murder weapon and I don't have a witness?
The girlfriend testified too, and I think they said it was like 8 hours of testifying by the girlfriend.
Right. Yeah.
And she changed her story up a couple times, she mentioned, I was just reading this last night, she mentioned that the murder weapon, she did see a gun that matched the description of the murder weapon in the house. She talked about the box that she removed from the house and how she lied the first time. So after reading that story, and I know there's lots of stories out there, I felt like, man, he may be going down. But
now, the fact that you brought up all of the circumstantial evidence, Vonnie asked earlier, do you think this is because he's a New England Patriot? The fact that people are willing to overlook circumstantial evidence is because he's a Patriot. I mean, if me, you, and Vonnie leave to hang out 20 minutes from now, and then 30 minutes after that, you're found dead with a blunt that I've been smoking on next to your body, I would expect people to question me about that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And then, do you have a gun? Yeah, I got a gun. Well, where is it? I mean, you know, I don't really know right now where it is. Well, okay, where were you? I can't really tell you that. Well, don't you have security film? Well, I did, but I towed a camera up and ripped up the system. And you know what I mean? Come on, man. Everybody else would go, he did it. But because it's a New England Patriot, everybody's like, well, maybe he didn't. Because they don't want to believe that someone would squander an opportunity like life in the NFL over murder.
Going back to that pedestal that you were talking about with Tiger, it's just that across the board. It's
exactly. No one wants to believe that this man has gotten a golden opportunity like this and is just going to throw it away over an argument in a strip club. No one's that stupid.
And
so
especially that he knew the gentleman. The gentleman has been in his house, probably slept in his house.
Yeah.
We can't find anything that's friction between the two people. That there's, you know, you haven't presented what would he kill him for?
But this is the same man alleged.
What motive?
Well, that's the thing. There, from the stories that they've heard, he had one case where a gentleman said that Aaron Hernandez shot him in the face over an argument about a bill at a strip club, like who should pay more or something like that. So if he's that type of a loose cannon, then maybe his motive is just, no, you didn't stand up against Aaron Hernandez. You know what I mean? But they're not allowing any of that type of evidence into the trial. So he's got some very good lawyers who have done a very good job of making it look like the prosecution hasn't presented their case. And if he walks out, I just want to see how the NFL is going to handle letting him back in the league, because if he's found not guilty, he deserves his job back.
Yes.
By law. He deserves to get his job back.
You're right.
Yeah, I think he will get an opportunity. I mean, I know you. Why are you over
he's
there?
Good. He's good.
He's a killer on the field.
He was good.
Speaking on the field, David Cornwell, the attorney for Jameis Winston, went on record saying he's ready to be an NFL player on the field, but he's not ready to be an NFL player off the field. This is the attorney that has been helping Jameis, I guess, way back to the rape allegations. He has gone on record to say this. I think that I can put it in context, but I think other people would probably fire him for saying this. But, you know, he went on to say that most kids aren't ready for the NFL 19, at 19, 20 years old, which is true.
Agreed.
To handle that kind of, I mean, we're talking about a top one or two pick. Cameron's going to follow him for good or bad the whole season. Even if he doesn't play, it'd be like Johnny Manziel. You know, they always pan the camera over there. What is Johnny doing on the sideline? Everything was part of the conversation. Jameis Winston, as I always said, his name can't get any bigger. He either can live up to the name or fail the name. But for how he's already come out of college, winning the Heisman, winning the national title, he's already as big as he can be. Vonnie, I'll ask you, do you see the things that Jameis has done, the troubles, they say, as that big of a head case? Because that's always what people want to put on him, as though I always see it as age appropriate. Most people find it that they feel like he's a head case.
You know what? First of all, if I ever get in trouble, I want David Cornwell to represent me, because he gets everybody off. I don't know how he does it. He is the man. In fact, I was driving in. He was on the satellite radio. He had a whole segment. It was like 30 minutes long talking about Jameis Winston, which I thought was interesting, like you said. Jameis Winston, yes, he's young. You know, I have a 15-year-old daughter, so when you tell me, my daughter's about to go off to college sometime soon, when you tell me just because you're a football player and my daughter, if she finds herself in that situation and you make her feel uncomfortable or possibly sexually assault her, then I don't care who you are. I want you to go to jail and do your time if that's the crime. You know, that's just how I feel about it. So I don't agree that that's just age appropriate, that part of it. The crab thing, that's him feeling like he's big in life. That's it. I'm the man on this campus. I'm gonna walk into the store one night, I don't know if it was a dare or whatever it was, prank, I'm gonna go get these crab legs and walk out. That's age appropriate. I mean, that could happen. The thing in the cafeteria and the student union standing up, it's once again social media. I mean, you just have to be cognitive of what's going on around you. This is our time, this is where we are. To stand up on a table and repeat the saying, I can't say it on air, but I know, you know, we know what he said.
Help him in the pee.
Yeah. That's what everybody's doing. I mean, that's what they were doing. It's not, that's age appropriate. It's just unfortunate. You know, he's Jameis Winston. He's the man. Somebody called on social media.
You know, Vonnie, they had to tell us not to say the word like three times when the first story came out.
Well, after we were just screaming
it all through the microphone. And then they had a little meeting with us.
After the Michael Sams thing, I figured I couldn't say that.
Right.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, some stuff, yeah, it is age appropriate. And I've been rooting for this young man, and he does some things that gets under your skin a little bit, but I do want to see him succeed. I would like to see him live up to the name, like you said. I mean, he's a phenomenal athlete. I think he has an opportunity to do some big things. I just hope that off the field, he has to go to a team, and you know how this is in a locker room. He needs to go to a team where you have some veteran players around him to teach him, to show him what it is to be a professional on and off the field. And I had that in Reggie White and Brett Favre and Dorsey Levins and those guys, and even in the offseason, hanging out with you, locker room lawyer Wayne Gandy.
But let me ask you something.
I think that's what all these kids need. Whether they're in scandal situations or not, because at 19, I don't think that you're financially, socially, or emotionally ready to deal with all the stuff that comes with it. And they throw these guys into these situations and then, you know, expect them to act better than most 25-year-olds.
With things like attorney-client privileges, I'm sure there are some things that his lawyer knows about him that we don't even know. And if his attorney is willing to say that, not only think it, but to say it, is this maybe an opportunity to defuse some sort of ticking bomb? Because this man has seen a pattern of behavior that makes him think you're not ready to go to the next level emotionally, personally. Now, you can play on the field, but you're a problem waiting to surface. But that says something to me. Do you think it affected his draft status?
I think that we'll talk about it when we come back from break, but I just want to go back 30 years and have a camera around any of the top quarterbacks. You'll probably find out they are alcoholics. You'll find out that they are rapists. You'll find out that they are racist. Absolutely. He just happens to live in an era.
That and all of those people were just Brett Favre. And you know what I mean?
We'll be back. Don't talk about it. Oh, get a little more space over there. Be back with more of the Sports Talk Show right after this. Welcome back to the Sports Talk Show. I'm the Sports Talk, Wayne Gandy. Le'Veon Bell is somewhere right now doing that. No. He said he didn't do it.
Down in the car. He waiting on me.
Oh, as we left, we were talking with Miss Erica Ashby, Kenny, myself, and Mr. Know Everything, Vonnie Holiday out of the University of North Carolina. We were talking about Jameis Winston and his situation. I think that I give him a lot of room because I know that the best thing of my era was you were able to go be the football player and then you were able to go just be the student. Now with social media and how the media invades college, it's you want me to live like and act like a pro when as soon as I get some stardom. And I feel like it's a lot of pressure on these kids. Standing on the table in the quad is a college student.
No doubt.
I saw the crab legs. I think me and Big Kenny, they wrote down shoplifting. No. You don't already have some cooked crab legs ready. That's not sure. That's a phone call. Hey, Eric, look, how long is it? Hey, come by in about 20 minutes. I'm going to have that pound ready for you.
Right.
You want some shrimp with that? You know. He walked in, he walked out. That's not shoplifting.
That's the hookup.
I've been with some shoplifters in college.
Right. That's the hookup.
Right. And you get back, you leave the store, you just happen to get back to the dorm, and it's a pack of sausage in the back seat. Where the sausage come from?
Steaks, T-bones.
Where you get sausage from, man?
Why are you pulling hamburgers out of your pants? You
know? That's shoplifting.
When did you find time to get mustard?
If you go and watch Jameis Winston, he walked into the supermarket, somebody handed him some crab legs, and he walked out. That's just being caught on camera getting the hookup.
But now, Vonnie, I would like to say if we can pull a picture of Jameis Winston up, one of the reasons we believe that Sports Joc supports him as much as he does in his actions is that Jameis Winston is actually the illegitimate son
of the Sports Joc.
Of the Sports Joc. Yes, if you look at them side by side, you would see that, and they're from Florida. From Florida. I'm just trying to connect the dots.
Jameis.
Oh, wow.
Come on now. Now, if we could get a picture.
From bottom of Georgia somewhere. Isn't that where you're from?
He's from Georgia somewhere.
How long have you been living here?
Cause you live in Georgia now. I'm saying you live in Georgia now.
He lives right off of 75.
And you played at Auburn, and Georgia's in the SEC. So once again, I'm just connecting dots here. I'm not making any accusations, but can you see the resemblance?
I see the resemblance.
Now that you say that, I see the resemblance.
Hey, I'm telling you,
probably a third cousin somewhere.
Right.
Look up my family tree.
Hey man,
maybe he had him with a third cousin. It is South Georgia.
That's what I'm saying. Either way it go, I'm sure he's about to go to the draft. You ain't got to worry about child support now.
No, he'll be making more money than me.
you can get some parental support now.
Oh, man. Speaking of the NFL, Marshawn Lynch, Bonnie, Big Kenny, Erica, in a new Ludacris video. I don't know if we can play the words because it's about every third word they are cursing, but can we at least see Marshawn in this video? This new song of Ludacris is called Beast Mode. And if you're watching on the page, Ludacris is doing an interview, and he's acting like he's Marshawn Lynch. And at some point, Marshawn jumps in there, and he only says like six words, which is about the longest he speaks anyway.
Is that him?
I was about to say, that's more than he said to the media this year.
He'll be the big guy in the back. There he is, right there. As you know, out of Seattle,
I play football.
They have that new Beast Mode 2.0 at the local dispensary. If you want to get a little taste of that out there. Big Kenny said he's growing him a new strain of that in his garage. Is that what you?
For all the law enforcement officials listening right now, it is not actually at my residence, as by my probationary standards, I'm not allowed to be within so many feet. But
I'm saying I could. You could go on.
It's been a long time since we've seen. I don't know if you ever met Marshawn in a hole on the line. Yes, you played against him.
Yes, I have.
Is it that hard to bring him down as it seems like it is on TV?
I would say this. I was older at the time. This is probably my 14th season.
Okay, you was holding on for dear life.
Yeah, man. Last game of the season. Some guys got hurt, so I had to go in and play a lot that game. The last game of the season, getting ready for the, you know, I'm in Arizona. I'm packing the house up, getting ready. We're not going to the playoffs. So I'm getting ready to come back to the A. I got to play. Like,
you asking dudes, why don't they stay in better shape? Why don't you take better care of yourself? I got to play now.
I got to play 50 snaps in a game. So I come off.
I was going to frame this jersey.
Wait. I mean, it's like textbook. I read the play. I come off, stand the guard up, throw him outside. All of a sudden, goes head to head with Marshawn, and I hit him about as hard as I've hit any running back. And he bounces off, takes a couple steps back. I'm thinking that, you know, most guys go down. I have to regroup and grab him again. And then throw him down. I mean, he acknowledged it was a hard hit, but he's beast mode. I mean, he keeps those legs going. He's hard to bring down. He is a tremendous competitor. You know, Adrian Peterson, Marshawn Lynch, I mean, those guys are just – I mean, they really go into a different mentality in beast mode when they're on the field. Adrian Peterson actually runs and grunts. It's like you see the commercials with the cartoons with the bulls and the smoke's coming out of their nose and they're grunting as they run.
Right.
That's AP. And Marshawn Lynch is right there with
him. And he always goes, I play football. I play football. I can run it fast. I am running so fast.
It's so funny you say that because you do have that moment where you realize I only have so many games. You don't really be looking at it, but you go out there and there's some young new model on the field, and you go to blocking him.
Because you're all trucks. Yeah.
Basically.
You'd be thinking, man, I got about 12, 13 more games.
And then you hit Marshawn and you think, okay, maybe nine, eight more games. Because he shortens your season, I'm sure. When you get to that point, you start thinking, maybe I'll just.
Yeah, these new, better-looking models, you look across the line, and you're thinking, man, it's going to take all of my effort to block this dude today.
These 2014s, they got bigger engines and everything.
Oh, man. That is funny. But Marshawn Lynch, once again, in the news, beast mode. I wish we could play, but Ludacris is cursing about every. But he should be happy. He won that case against that girl, didn't he? She pays him child support.
Oh, really?
Wait a minute.
Or something like that?
Ludacris gets paid child support?
I think
didn't his movie Fast and Furious just record sales?
Yeah, but I think he did it for the whole principle of the thing because she got pregnant to thought trap him.
Well, yeah, I think how could they prove that?
He proved that he'd be a better parent.
And no, the thought trap. Because they had sex. Because they had sex and he went in with Riggity, right?
Yeah.
So what's the trap?
This is true.
Well, I only wonder where she's going to get the money from. Like, you know, Ludacris is going to get a piece of her Popeye's fried chicken check. You know what
and
I mean?
And I figured out what the trap is. The trap is like, how many women are going to do that? They weren't in a relationship, right? Wasn't she just like some...
I don't know. Well, I mean, once again, if you're not in a relationship and you end up having a child, that shows some lack of forethought or planning or preparation or responsibility. Because you were just to jump off, and now we raising a kid together. So
on both people's part.
Right, on both people's part, most definitely. But how he showed her to be the irresponsible one that he got, because as a person that's gone through divorce and custody issues, it's really, really hard for people to go, nah, take that mom,
divorce,
right?
You big kid.
I know, right? You know what I'm saying? I know. That's what I'm saying. I'm the kind of guy, I used to let her talk and everything.
So you lost. You lost. You lost. I could tell. You lost.
You
couldn't afford the lawyers that Luda had.
That's what I'm saying. And she took everything. You know what I mean? I mean, but you got to be like a super bad mother. Like an attorney told me, look, you're going to have to get her on film smoking crack and beating the child with a shoe. Right. To even get them to consider giving you custody.
Speaking of losing, Odell Beckham Jr., I don't know why he keeps running against Diddy. Diddy lost his foot race. What is this, Bunny? Could you help me out? They're having a foot race in this video up here. If you're watching the Sports Joc page, I'm figuring the guy, the bigger guy right there,
Hold up. He won.
No, that's Deshaun Golston. You got the wrong video over there. I need the Odell Beckham. I don't even know why Diddy racing any of these people.
And look, the producers are like, it's all football players running against Diddy. It's Diddy and a football player. You want me to be specific?
But that was Deshaun John. I mean, Ghost in the safety.
I don't believe it anyway. Wait a minute.
Diddy, ain't you got no meeting to go to? What are you doing? Like, do you just call up people like, what you doing today? Nothing. You want to race? How do these men? I mean, I would think their schedules would be filled. When do you find the time to race Diddy down an alley?
I never even knew New Yorkers did foot races like that. Out in the open, in the streets.
They fast. They fast.
From pole to pole, that kind of stuff.
Like literally, like in the street, like cars can't go nowhere.
Shut it down.
Yeah, that's what the streets are for. That's why the subway is so popular.
Okay, right. Got you. Well,
that's where I learned how to jump a fence in New York. My cousins. Yeah, it was they moved. It's a skill, a skill set.
Were y'all practicing robbing the getaway? I'm going to go back and jump this fence.
Yeah, why were you jumping fences?
Long story. No social media back then.
That's what I'm saying. You don't tell.
So say that again.
That's part of the training process. Learn to jump a fence and keep your mouth shut. That's what they do.
Yeah, we used to jump fences to get in the pig pens, steal the little Debbie cakes.
In the pig pens?
Yeah. At the little.
That's a different life.
They go over there, right?
Yeah, don't act like we gonna just go past Pig Pen and Little Debbie Cakes. We gonna revisit that.
Is that where they hid the Debbie Cakes?
We'll be back for more of the Sports Joc Show right after this.
The Wayne Gandy Football Camp turns 20 this year, coming to Haines City, Florida, April 25th. Over the past 20 years, participants have included Warwick Dunn, Hines Ward, and Roddy White, just to name a few. Call Andrew Williams for more info at 863-221-9190 or email info at thesportsjoc.com.
Enough is enough! I have had it!
Why so serious?
And we hold the world ransom for
Wayne Gandy.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Show me. Broadcasting live from the Armada FM studios in Atlanta, Georgia. This is the Sports Joc Show with Wayne Gandy.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. Quick news and notes. Fast and the Furious. I don't know if y'all went out and saw Fast and the Furious. It was kind of morbid, knowing that Paul Walker had passed away. But we made it through. It was a little long, a little unrealistic, but it was entertaining. I don't know if it was $15 entertaining, but ticket prices seem to be going up. And I don't know. I'm going to have to watch two movies for that $9 Coke. I don't know about y'all, but I might just have to start sneaking to an extra movie. I feel like if I'm going to pay $9 for a Coke, I need to be there a while. Because that Coke is real expensive. The popcorn is like $12 as well. And I would hate to be 17 trying to take a girl on a date. That's all I'm saying, because movie date is like $80. And what, 17, 18-year-old kid, I didn't have it. My movies were $3. And y'all just the same age as me. Don't look at me like I'm the only one who knows something about the $3 movie. When you probably snuck through the back door, Erica. I know y'all will hold the door. Well, you pay, and then the rest of us going to go in the back. Then all of y'all, but now they got that seat numbering, so that cuts all that out. They weren't doing that for any reason other than to make sure you're not sneaking in the next movie. Don't let Hollywood fool you. Nelly, it's hot in here. It was hot on that bus. What are you doing, Nelly? You moving weight through Tennessee? I don't know. Nelly being charged with felony drug charges. He was trying to get that weight down here to Big Kenny, but they pulled the bus over and 40 years old, sitting in jail. Well, you know Nelly? Y'all used to date? No?
Yeah, on the show he plays my
dad. Oh, does
he? Yeah.
Oh, well, it'll be me next year then. Because he's going to be in next. Hey, call him. Look how she. Oh, we'll be able to get some real scoop on Nelly. Well, Nelly got pulled over in Tennessee. The cop actually pulled him over for a Transportation and International Fuel Tax Association sticker. Was not on the bus. That's why they got pulled over. The police smelled marijuana. When they went on the bus, they had felony-type weight on the bus and illegal firearms. This was 9:20 a.m. They got pulled over. That is Nelly. DMX, he was in the news last week. He robbed somebody on Easter. Did y'all get some of that? DMX robbing people on Easter at gunpoint, stole $3,200. Everybody missed that. DMX, that used to get me through the games, DMX. Y'all don't know DMX, do you? No. No. Is he still on crack? That makes you think he's still on crack. You're robbing people, right? $3,200 at gunpoint. Yes, he'll be doing some time. And if you're an old Dukes of Hazzard fan back in the day, James Best, old Roscoe Pico Train, passed away, 88 years old. And Bruce Jenner will be on with Diane Sawyer to discuss his sexual change on April 24th. So any of you that want to see Bruce Jenner go through his becoming a woman at 70, that'll be time to check that out. But we are sitting here. I have my good friend, Mr. Vonnie Holiday, Big Kenny, the beautiful Erica Ash, who is trying to hook up people with her best friend that she keeps saying is nice, which all us guys know what nice mean. Boo. Who's that, Serena?
Oh. Yeah, that's Serena.
Oh, somebody in blackface.
Hey, and don't nobody try and hook nobody up with Serena. You know Serena is my boo. Sports Joc, I just want to say, what is going on in the world? First of all, Nelly moving meth. I guess it's the drug of the future, so he's just trying to be, you know what I'm saying, a smart entrepreneur forecasting growth trends in the business. Mm-hmm. But that's dangerous. DMX, if he is on crack, $3,200 buy a lot of crack.
I'm just saying that was
a robbery that he was probably glad about. But can you imagine being robbed by DMX on Easter? How confused you would be. Yo, my man, let me get them peeps and everything in your pocket. I want them jelly beans and them chocolate rabbits. Oh, oh.
I'm confused about who carries $3,200 just as pocket change. That's
well,
what I want.
Whoever,
like,
whoever.
No.
Vonnie got $3,200.
Right,
but I think what I took from this last little length of conversation, what I took away most was that somewhere you know where to get coke for $9. And I'm just saying. I heard $9 in coke, and I'm thinking he's complaining about that price? These people are giving it away. Look, send me to that theater, and I don't care what's playing. Let's get me like seven of those $9 cokes. I'll be making money in the bathroom while y'all watch the movie.
Oh, and one quick note for you people. If you know about this show, we have been doing a pledge to bring back America after the University of California college students tried to take down the American flag at the student union down in El Salvador in the month of March. 481 homicides. So when you think America is so bad, wow. 481 homicides in March down in El Salvador.
Even Chicago's like, damn.
Since April 1st, there has been 73 murders in El Salvador. They are on pace to pass Honduras as the deadliest peacetime country in the world.
So, and which just answered my question, is this like war numbers, but this is peacetime?
This
numbers,
peacetime. So just in case y'all think America is so bad, you know, there's other places that is really going down when you can kill 500 people, murders in 1 month.
Wow. What's going on? Hey, my friend, You step on my shoes. You moved your shoes, man. Hey, hold on. I deep him to step on shoes, man. He never step on nobody else's shoes again.
So, I just thought that was a lot of...
it's a lot of murders.
Murders.
Yeah.
That's like a yearly supply of Chicago.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Even Chicagoans are like, wow, that's a lot.
That's a lot.
They need to stop playing.
They need to stop playing.
And... that was it. Well, Vonnie, we thank you for coming in, man, and helping us out.
No, no doubt. I still want to know, okay, a couple things. Rand Paul talked about getting America back. I don't know what that means. I would like to – we were talking about that I was talking about that earlier with some friends. What does that mean to get America back, Wayne? I know you grew up in North Florida or somewhere down there. We've had some interesting conversations.
Central Florida.
Mm-hmm. We had some interesting conversations about your upbringing there in Central Florida. But none more interesting than – the little Debbies in the pig pen.
Let's revisit that. Thank you, Vonnie.
Thank you.
We thought we was just gonna smooth that over and go past that.
That's worth being on the show.
We will hear that. We was just gonna get all the formalities out of the way.
I lived in a rural part of.
You think?
of Florida, where people kept pig pens and chicken coops.
There's chickens right outside.
We get all of that. We saying how they marry the chicken coop and the pig pen with the snack cake.
The guy Cecil Gunner, was it Hunter Gunner? One of them, the daddy. He would go around to the local, like 7-Elevens and things like that, because you know they have to get rid of the things they don't sell when it expires.
It expires, right?
So he would go there and get those kind of items for the slop. In my household, we grew up on store brand, so the only way at that time to get like name brand stuff, me and some of the friends in the neighborhood, we walked like a mile away, and we would wait till he dumped all the little Debbies on the side, because you know he had so many he didn't give them to the pigs all at once, and we would find the boxes that were not open, and that's how we would get our little Debbie cakes, and then we would mess with the hogs.
I just want y'all to know thank y'all for listening.
But that does explain why
Sports Joc, all that you've taught me over this run, I really appreciate, but I'm gonna be moving on in life right now. I mean I'll be a lot of things, you know, all the charges and all the criminal history, but the whole little Debbie snack cake pig pen thing is where I personally draw my line. I don't want to speak for anybody else.
We would run around and we would chase the pigs and the hogs and stuff, and you know,
which is age appropriate. That's age appropriate.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, you know, I was 16, but I'm messing with you. This was when I was like probably.
I was finna say whoa.
Tell the truth,
8 to about 12, no 13. But we would look at the date, make sure it wasn't old, and find the freshest box. We would find the freshest box
of snack cakes behind the barn next to the pig pen.
That were expired.
By the way, Wayne, you remember Hustle and Flow?
Yes.
You remember the microphone situation in Hustle and Flow? Like, I'm looking at you guys have these nice microphones, and why does my microphone have this little yellow?
he got to take Erica up in the music store and get him a new mic. You know what I mean?
Whoop that. No, you can't say that on there, but they do. It took a long time for me to get a working mic.
Okay.
I used to have to fix my mic as we went.
I used to stand here and just sit here and hold mine literally for 3 hours.
But, Vonnie, we appreciate you coming on, man. And,
thanks for
hopefully
me.
You can do it another time. Good luck to you. Say hello to the wife.
Thank you.
And I thought you had 6 kids.
Two kids.
Two.
Man. Two kids, 15 okay. and 9.
Oh, you proved the other 4 was.
You are not the father.
Hey! Do the dance.
This is Vonnie Holiday. We'll be back with more of the Sports Joc Show right after this.
A week ago.
It was all a dream. Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. It is Monday. It is in the 11 o'clock hour. We like to thank Mr. Vonnie Holiday for coming in. Good friend, as I said, 15 years in the NFL with the Packers, Arizona, Miami, the Washington Redskins. Man, I had to face a couple of time across the line. Thank him for coming in. Looking well still. Doesn't seem like he has CTE at all. Moving around.
Is that a strong concern when you see friends that you hadn't seen in a while that you played with back in the golden days of football when you played in the day of the leather helmet and the actual metal spiked cleat
in the Chinese calendar of the year of the egg?
Yeah. I think that we all probably look at each other to first and foremost see if you gain any weight,
right,
would be first.
You know, Michael Sams is sure checking for that. you done got fat.
How you're walking to see how, you know, how healthy your legs are. And probably the third would be, do you still have any money? Are you, you know.
So all the things we look for.
So I would think those are probably the three things. But Vonnie, who's always been a good guy and smart player, even though UNC never went to class,
right,
seems like he is done well.
When I run into all of my friends I hadn't seen in a long time, my first question is usually, you got out?
How long you been out?
when you come home?
I thought you were going to say, did you take the honey bun?
No, bro. We know before we go in, no honey buns, dude. We sugar free.
Well, for the Sports Joc Show, you know, we always try to kind of live on the edge in a sense and bring stories to light that people sometimes overlook. And we definitely we love anything that's about competition. As I said at the beginning of the show, I went to a lingerie football game on Saturday. They have changed it to the Legends Football League up in Gwinnett Center, the Atlanta Steam. We had Richard Brown, a graduate of Morehouse, who has been in the Olympics. He told us his story of losing a limb and still rising to become a great track runner. Today, if you have been listening to the last couple of shows, we have talked about a very interesting competition. We know here, it's kind of fading away. A lot of beauty pageants have faded away, at least the popularity of them. They used to be huge when I was a kid. It was like, who's going to be Miss America? Who's going to be Miss Universe? It used to.
Before internet porn.
A couple of weeks ago, I reported on an interesting competition that none of us knew about. And that's why we like to bring awareness to it and things like that, because people are out here living their dreams, still showing you that regardless of what happens, you can still get up off the mat and become something. We have Miss Leslie Peoples in the building. She is Miss Wheelchair Georgia. And I know some of you are like, yes, y'all have talked about this. And it's just more interesting to me because you never know what's going on behind doors. And you think people in this situation would not even want to probably be a part of something like this, because you're, I guess, if you're not having hard times, you're very sympathetic. And some people, just like we learned with Richard Brown, they're not looking for you to be sad for them. But to understand that you can still get up, make life, even out of sad situation. Miss Leslie Peoples is here. She is Miss 2015 Georgia Wheelchair. She will be in the 2015 or 2016 Wheelchair America. Is that correct? She has a bachelor's degree from Fort Valley State. Who was on here with the book from Fort Valley? Tyrone. Who was at that time?
Tyrone Poole,
my friend. Yeah. Tyrone Poole.
Yeah, great friends. Can't remember. Who was that? The guy from he's my buddy, cousin.
Tyrone Poole, Fort Valley State graduate, played in the league about 12, 13 years.
Super Bowl champion,
yes. She has a bachelor's degree in criminal justice.
Yes.
And now she is getting her master's in clinical rehabilitation. Yes, okay, see.
Nice.
See, that's how I like to test myself. Because I thought I had to drop off in CTE, and now I'm back. But I guess that's how it worked, right?
I was a huge fan until I found out criminal justice.
Well, good morning to you, Ms. Peoples.
Thank you for having me. Thank you for having me.
You two met last night at the United Negro Fund. Is that what that's
called?
Okay.
No, we actually didn't meet. It was the United Negro College Fund.
Hey, wherever you coloreds gather, and don't get specific.
They still have that?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. It was a really nice event last night.
Oh, okay. Where was it held?
The Civic Center.
In the cotton field? No, man. I'm just joking, man. They work on the indoors now.
Was it
Sheriff over here.
Talk to me. I've never been to that.
Well, you tell them about it.
Okay. Basically, the night, it's an evening with the stars. It's an award show for children who receive scholarships through the United Negro College Fund who attend HBCUs, Fort Valley. And basically, they were just handing out money all night.
Really?
All night.
Nobody called me.
Well, that's
it.
Why you didn't go, because you don't need money. And I didn't go because they didn't want me to rob the money.
And
so
I was there with my mom. Both
of you. They know who to invite.
Okay. How many years have they been doing that? I know. I remember it was in. It's kind of like the beauty pageant. You remember watching that, and now it kind of fell off. Like Lou Rawls.
Lou Rawls and the telethon and stuff.
Lou Rawls still do the telethon? No.
This has actually been going on continuously. I think it's just, you know, they've publicized it.
They've been doing the UN.
Off, but then it comes, you know.
Yeah, they've been doing the UNCF since they's beating black folks coming across the bridge. You know what I mean?
So you were there. It was a great evening, I take it. Okay. Yeah. And y'all didn't meet? You just saw each other?
We didn't meet, but the host or, you know, the warm-up comic who came in between was kind of, you know, giving shouts out to different people.
They locked eyes.
Exactly.
And she noticed her, and she noticed her.
Yeah. Okay. Two women sizing each other up. They do that, though.
Yeah, you know they do that.
Yeah. She got that 2001 bag. Y'all ain't know what y'all do?
Oh, goodness.
That was last year we...
Some of them, not all of them.
Right.
Some of them.
Well, Ms. Peoples, thank you for joining us. Wheelchair.
Yes.
Pageant.
Yes.
When you say that to people, I would imagine they are surprised.
Always. I guess the biggest thing that people don't realize is people in wheelchairs do exist.
Okay.
A lot of people assume that, oh, they're in a wheelchair, they're just homebodies, they don't go anywhere, they don't do anything. But that's a really big common misperception that people like me and other people who not only do pageants, people are doctors, people are lawyers, people in wheelchairs are out here in America. And for some of us, we just want to do pageants. You know, we feel like we have a reason or a season. It's time to show it. So for me, I love talking to people. I love, you know, naturally God made me beautiful. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
So why not, you know, advocate for other people? You know, why not be that little hope for, you know, the next little girl who feels like, you know, I don't know what to do with myself, so I'm just going to sit at home. No, baby, stand up. You have a reason. You are beautiful. No matter your disability, you are able. So that's why I'm out here to advocate for other girls. And it's a lot of us out here of the brown complexion that don't do anything. We feel like, oh, beauty pageants are, you know, for other girls. No, it's for every girl. It doesn't matter. So that's why I'm here.
I'm so glad you're here. Because this one right here, she brings none of that good old... She coming here and talking about she want to choke people on the plane.
No.
She talking about she want to kill people on the plane this morning. You bring us. We're going to go to break. We're going to come back.
It's beautiful to see that even in a wheelchair, you stuck up enough to say you beautiful on the radio. You know what I'm saying? I love that about you. We going to connect real strong.
We'll be back. More of the Sports Joc Show and Ms. Leslie Peoples right after this quick break.
More of the Sports Joc Show with Wayne Gandy.
Atlanta Olive Oil Company is this week's Sports Joc of the Week sponsor. Located at 1133 Huff Road, Suite F, Atlanta, Georgia. Visit them this week for samples of the Sports Joc Oil of the Month, Black Walnut BV. Atlanta Olive Oil Company is more than just a place to buy gourmet-infused olive oils and balsamic vinegars. It's a unique gathering place for tastings and intimate settings. Located at 1133 Huff Road, Atlanta, Georgia, Atlanta Olive Oil Company, proud sponsor of the Sports Joc Show.
Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. I'm sitting here with the funny man himself, Big Kenny, and the beautiful and lively and sometimes violent... It's Erica Ash. We have a special guest in the studio, Miss Wheelchair Georgia, Miss Leslie Peoples, Big Kenny, Erica. Before Leslie, if I have this correct, there was no Miss Wheelchair Georgia.
There wasn't. The state of Georgia is an independent delegate state, which means that they didn't actually have enough candidates to actually run for a pageant. So it kind of went off the application process. But this upcoming year, I will be the state coordinator for the state of Georgia. So there will be a Miss Georgia, a Miss Wheelchair Georgia pageant.
Now, when is the Miss America Wheelchair?
The Miss Wheelchair America pageant will be held on July 27th through August the 2nd in Des Moines, Iowa.
Kind of random. Des Moines, Iowa. Is there a reason?
Well, every year is a different location.
Okay,
so.
Okay. I thought maybe that was the birthplace of some whoever started it.
Well, they can focus because there's nothing else to do there. Let me ask you this. Yeah. How did you get started in wheelchair pageantry? Like, how did?
Actually, after my injury, I was actually told by somebody, like, oh, you know, you're really pretty, and to be in a wheelchair. And I was kind of offended by that. And I just didn't understand, like, why would you say I'm pretty because I'm in a wheelchair? Why aren't I just pretty because I'm a pretty person? So clearly some people didn't see me. They saw the chair. So I said, okay, well, what do other people that are pretty in wheelchairs do? So I just Googled, what about pageants for people in wheelchairs? I pulled it up, and long and behold, there it was, Miss Wheelchair America. So I said, okay, well, if I'm pretty to be in the chair, let's see if I'm pretty enough to stand with the rest of them. And there it was.
Huh. Wow. I'm sorry. How did you end up?
No, go ahead. Monopolize the show.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. this is me and her. We're having a moment right now.
Thank you. You lost your time. You decided to get smart with her.
Yes.
Y'all go ahead.
Oh, because I'm coming back. You can believe that. Y'all get it all in now. I'm coming back.
And let's see, was it June of 2013? I was in.
Hold on 1 second. The mic keep going out. Is it back up now?
Mediocre producer strikes again.
Go ahead.
Strikes again.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. There you go.
In June of 2013, I was involved in a fatal car accident. I was traveling on a 2-lane highway, and a minivan who decided to drive the wrong side of the road to go around a dumpster truck. I was coming up a hill, they were coming up the other side and ran head on into my vehicle. And the driver of that vehicle, she passed away on impact, and I had a fatality in my vehicle, and I was left paralyzed from the waist down.
Oh my goodness.
Having read that story before you got here, I know a friend of mine who was in a car accident and they woke up paralyzed. And the most difficult part was when they told him, in fact, sometime later, because they let him believe that maybe he'd recuperate. Right. But later they finally told him that he wouldn't walk again. He said it was difficult to learn that to have had two people lose their life and you be paralyzed. Did you feel like you were the lucky one in that situation?
Not in the beginning, because the passenger who was in my vehicle, she was 16. And at the time, I was 23. So I felt like, if there was somebody who deserved to live, why not give it to somebody younger than myself? I've always been a very unselfish person. So when it comes to life, I felt like she deserved a chance. And she didn't get that chance because somebody else was selfish enough to drive on the wrong side of the road and take it away from her. So I guess I don't know if I'm going to sound, I'm blessed, period. I'm very
very blessed. I'm very grateful to be here. So, I guess I'm
Hold on one second. So, because we're having a little technical difficulty with her microphone right now.
Right.
There's a lot of static in it. I know that the last accident I was in, they didn't believe I was 15, so they thought I had a concussion. I got out the back of the truck, and I was in a truck in the back of a pickup, and this was not a king cab. We ran into a tree. I had to kick the window out. And for about 2 hours, I kept questioning whether I was 15.
Because he was freakishly large as a child.
Yeah.
And the last accident I was in, I got a wife and daughter out of it. So things happen.
Put your mic back on. Were you in any kind of pageant before the accident?
Never.
Any kind of cheerleading?
I was a varsity cheerleader.
Okay.
I did do competitive cheerleading in high school. In college, I did study criminal justice, so I had the aspiration of wanting to be a medical examiner. And right before my accident, I was transitioning into medical school. Then I got in my accident, and then everything just changed from there.
And now you want to get into clinical rehab.
Yes. After going through rehab at the Shepherd Center here in Atlanta, I was actually able to interact with some of the other patients, and it's kind of hard when you go through a therapy type setting with somebody who's a therapist, who's an able-bodied individual, and you sit there and they say, oh, you know, how are you feeling today? What are you going through? You really don't understand what I'm going through. You really don't know how I feel. So I felt like, why not give myself the opportunity to help somebody else who does understand? Why not sit across the table from somebody else who has been in the same type of accident as myself? So I feel like I'm a much better candidate for that, I guess, opportunity than somebody who's an able-bodied therapist of some degree.
How long did it take you to accept once you got the news that you were going to be paralyzed?
I don't accept it.
Okay.
If you believe it, it'll happen to you. If you believe something different, if you believe that you will get up one day, you will. It's a mental thing. I think paralysis is what it is. It paralyzes you. It makes you think that you can't do something. But if you want to do it, you just have to have the willpower to do it, period. Even if it's different, like the word disable, it doesn't mean we can't do it. We're just differently able to do the same thing anybody else can do.
Gotcha.
On the pageant circuit, we hear a lot of talk about women in pageants being catty and bitter and mean towards each other. Is it the same on the wheelchair pageant circuit? Are there some real bees on wheels?
That's actually a good question, only because, I mean, I would assume that he was being funny at first.
No. I ask good questions. I'm a radio professional. Excuse me.
I'm going to go fair to Midland.
It happens from time to time.
I'm going to go fair to Midland on that. But, no, just because people, you know, everybody's so much more grateful for, you know, being.
Well, most of the wheelchair pageants, they're not necessarily beauty pageants. They're abilities pageants. Who can be the best advocate for people within the disabled community? So for the most part, I can say everybody is really welcoming and warm towards one another. But there's, you know, it's always probably one or two.
Miss North Dakota. Call them out on the show. We know.
You just never know. Maybe somebody who's in a power chair, she might want to roll my foot over. You know, we hope not, but, you know.
You don't be like, ha-ha, I ain't even feel it.
But, you know, I didn't feel it anyway.
She rolled over your foot and everybody be like, you got the juice now.
They are profiling in wheelchairs. I heard that.
But it wasn't like a quick transition. And I'm asking you this for the benefit of other people out there who might see your story and be, you know, positively influenced by it. You know, how long has it been since your accident, first of all? And the second part of that question is, how long after the accident did you kind of get the idea to start doing this?
For me, it was almost instantaneously. Before my accident, I've always been a very strong-minded person. I've never settled for less than anything than perfection.
So when I was told I was paralyzed, it didn't register to me at first. Because, like, you know, y'all said, y'all been in accidents. And you kind of, you walked away from, I had a cut, bruise here. So for me, when I said, oh, I was in an accident, the first thing I'm thinking about is, ooh, my car is going to be paid off. Ooh, I'm going to, you know, give me this nice new Jeep Wrangler. It didn't register in my mind that, you know, a new reality is about to hit me. Mm-hmm. So when the doctor said, oh, you know, we're sorry, ma'am. You know, they say it in the worst way possible. They don't tell you in, you know, this heartfelt manner, like, oh, you're, you know, sorry, you're going to be paralyzed. They wake you up out your sleep and say, you know, you may never walk again, but we'll teach you how to roll in a wheelchair.
What has been the biggest transition? The one thing that you find was the hardest?
The hardest thing for me, I will say, is allowing other people not to feel sorry for me. Okay. Because a lot of people look at you and they, like you said before, they feel a sense of pity towards you. They feel like, oh, I'm so sorry you're in a wheelchair. I'm not sorry that I'm in a wheelchair. I'm sorry that other people in wheelchairs don't show you how fabulous our lives really are. Because just like anybody else, we're fine. Just because we're a little, we may sit a little differently, our clothes may fit differently, but we are normal people. So,
Are you dating? You roll around with anybody?
Well, you know, I'm out here on the scene. I'll say that.
I love it.
I'm saying because she's a beautiful woman. If you're watching the Sports Joc show, she's a very beautiful woman. So I had to ask. I didn't see a ring on your finger. And,
no.
And she's edumacated.
Yeah. She talk real straight.
Hey,
yeah,
she it don't make a difference. I'm not either. But we
know why in your case.
Why, Big Kenny?
That's for another show.
Well, we're going to go to break. We come back. If you have a moment to hold on, we have one more segment of our show. 888-926-7562. GoFundMe, is that what you want me to read? Because he loves to put stuff and think I read his mind.
I need money for my campaign.
GoFundMe, she is $595 away from her goal of $2,000. I'll read the rest when we come back. I don't know how to read computer. We'll be back right after this. Welcome back to the Sports Joc Show. I'm the Sports Joc, Wayne Gandy. A lost art, R&B music. Dead to some, still alive here on the Sports Joc Show. Real quickly, before we continue our conversation with the beautiful Miss Leslie Peoples. You know what? Forget all that other stuff right there. I don't even worry about that stuff there. We're done with all that stuff. Let's talk to Leslie. We can... NBA playoffs start Saturday. How about that?
How about it? And the news in that is that the Hawks will be participating. That's the news story, is that we're actually in the lead for once. So.
Just to catch you up, Ms. Peoples will be in the 2016 Miss Wheelchair America pageant in Des Moines, Iowa, July 27th through August the 2nd. How many participants are in this pageant?
This year there will be 28.
28. Okay, so we got a couple of more states to get right. Maybe Ron Paul can get them going. You know, with Hillary, somebody. Rand. Yeah, Ron. I know what his name is.
Yeah, Rand Paul, Ron Paul. It don't matter. Hush your Republican mouth. Leslie, what is the grand prize of winning the Miss Wheelchair USA pageant?
Well, for one, you get the title of Miss Wheelchair America. You receive your, I guess, official crown and sash of Miss Wheelchair America. You're able to go around the United States doing advocacy work, doing personal appearances, going around. Hopefully, we're trying to get into the White House this year. If I do make it, that is my goal, to get next to President Obama and basically be the best advocate, try and change laws, try and get things amended. A lot of places aren't wheelchair accessible depending on when they were established. So basically, get out there and change the world.
You a Delta?
Yeah.
Okay, Ruth, I'm the bro.
Me
so
too.
I didn't know that.
No, you don't ask the questions.
Oh, whatever.
Speaking of.
Right on. We're going to have to take one of them. Greek love pictures together.
Absolutely.
Yeah, with the dog in the middle.
You said something really, 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 really powerful. Mm-hmm. He asked you how long did it take you to accept it, and you said you don't accept it. Mm-hmm. So when you say that, are you hoping to one day be able to be on two legs again, or is it just the mentality that you're saying that you don't accept? And
both.
Okay.
For one, my injury level is very low. I'm an L3 spinal cord injury. So I guess most people don't really know the body until something happens to it. Mm-hmm. So for me, the lumbar is the very bottom of your spinal cord. It's only five, L1 through five, mm-hmm. and I'm L3. Mm-hmm. So for me, my injury level being so low, I do have the ability to utilize a lot of my body parts versus someone who may have a C-level injury who isn't able to use majority of their body. So for me, I have the ability to still move my legs. So as long as I strengthen them and continue to do physical therapy, I am able to stand, and then once you're able to stand, once my quads get stronger, I'm able to, you know, make steps of forward progressions, and eventually, with the assistance of walkers, I use crutches, with braces on my legs, all kinds of assistive technologies that are out here, I am able to walk.
Okay, mm-hmm. I like that.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
And at some point, you'll be able to shed it.
Hopefully, with, you know, that's all, you know, in God's time, because your spine and your nerves take a really long time to regenerate. If your nerves, for my injury, my nerves shot out of my spine. So for me, at my injury level, all the nerves at the L3 vertebrae were disconnected. Mm-hmm. So all the feeling from basically my waist down is gone. Mm-hmm. So, but they can regenerate, and there's so many stem cell research projects out here that I really do feel, in time, somebody's going to find, just like the cure to cancer, mm-hmm. somebody's going to find the cure to paralysis. And we'll all be up here running again.
Right.
How did your family support? How was that when you went to them like, Mom, Dad, I want to be in the Miss Wheelchair pageant?
They thought I was crazy. my mother, it's just me and my mother and my sister.
Okay.
And I told her, I actually didn't tell her at first because I said, okay, well, if I don't win, then I don't even want to mention it because I lost. And I don't believe in losing, so I didn't tell anybody. So then when I was selected as Miss Wheelchair Georgia, I told her, and she was like, oh, that's so cute. You know, you decided to make yourself up a pageant. And I tried to tell her, like, no, this is real. And right. She was like, yeah, okay, right. But then eventually when she researched it and she saw how many other, the pageant's been in existence for 44 years.
Oh, wow.
And when she saw it, she was just floored by it. And now she's involved. She's my personal PR agent in her mind. She's my momager, as she wants to call herself, but she doesn't do anything. but I love her. I love my mother. But that's her role.
I have two questions.
Yes.
One, are you able to have children?
Yeah, our bodies work just like everybody else.
Okay. You sounded like you want to have a baby with me the way you said that. Like, yeah, you want to have a baby? And we'd make a cute kid.
You got a
401k? She said you got a 401k.
I got 36 OZs. You can believe that. We still going to get this money. Don't make no difference. You know what I'm saying? We still going to get this money. This my point. That's not what I want you to take away from this conversation. I also want to ask, do you still do the girly stuff, like go get the pedicures?
Yeah, okay. For people with paralysis, you really have to watch your bodies because you don't have feeling in certain areas. So your body's more susceptible to injuries and you not notice them. So especially with our feet or our legs, our blood doesn't circulate the same anymore because you're sitting down, you know, majority of your day. So you really have to be very careful when you do things like pedicures and things of people touching your legs. But it's all possible. You just have to be very careful.
What about day-to-day activities? So, for instance, I noticed you came in by yourself.
Yeah, I drive.
You drive?
I drive. There's assistive technologies out here. I have hand controls in my car where I have one side for my gas pedal, one side for the brake.
Oh, nice.
Why not an electric chair?
For what?
Okay.
If you don't need it, why get it? You know, if you are able to move your arms, push yourself, because not only is that giving you your own physical therapy, you're actually motivating yourself to want to do better. If you're in a power chair, you know, by circumstance, that's different, you know, for people who are unable. But people who are lazy, they decide, oh, well, I'm just going to get a power chair and move my finger around. But if you push yourself to be in a manual chair, you're actually giving yourself therapy every day by pushing your arms. You're building up your muscle tone.
She's a Delta. She's
a Delta.
And all of those able-armed people in wheelchairs have just been called lazy.
No.
Hey, so all of you losers out there who could use your arms but won't.
Right. I mean, well,
I like that. I like that fighting spirit. Yeah.
If you can, I think that's a very valid point. I think it's the equivalent of people who just won't go to the gym. Like you can, you just won't, and then you know, you sit around and scream at the TV about who should play what on the field.
Do you? I don't know if you have an answer to this question or not. Most of the women that are in the pageant, do you know if they've always been in a wheelchair or some other stories are more like yours?
I think everybody may have their own different stories.
Okay.
It's abilities pageants of all different abilities. People who may have spinal bifida or, you know, people who have been in accidents or people who have born with, you know, birth defects is a different variety of different reasons. And we're all different injury levels.
How does the age range?
For 21 and up.
Okay.
For the Miss Wheelchair America pageant, but different states have state pageants, just like the regular, you know, Miss Georgia pageant, they have Little Miss Georgia, Miss Georgia Teen. They have Little Miss Wheelchair Georgia, things like that.
When you finally got out of the hospital, got in your wheelchair and started traveling around, did you become more aware of how limited access we allow people in wheelchairs here in the United States?
I have. And I'm always honest. So when I used to go around and maybe go to Target or something, like, oh, let me just park in a handicapped spot right quick while, you know, I run in the store. I really didn't understand it until I was in that position myself. I didn't appreciate, oh, it's a reason why this spot is up here for somebody who really needs it. And it kind of aggravates me now because I see people and I just sit in my car and I wait for them to move. And then they look at me when I finally get in, they're like, oh, I feel bad. You know, right. I shouldn't have been there. You know, it really gives you a whole new outlook and perspective on life.
You've obviously never run into me at in a handicapped spot because I'd be like, whatever,
Don't ever move to Florida.
Let me find you. You'll run into me. Let me find
real hard.
Don't move to Florida because all the handicapped spots
what
are taken down.
What's going on with this flirting between the two of
you? I am not flirting with her. I am openly making.
We are glad that you came.
Making remarks. This is no subversive. Yeah.
About this. We are glad that you took the time to come and
Thank
go
you
on
for
the show.
Having me.
Put the GoFundMe. You started this.
Yes, I started a GoFundMe page to help me raise my money for my campaign. Each candidate has to raise a certain amount of money to go towards our travel expenses and pageant expenses. So my goal is set at $2,000, but I'm hoping to exceed it. I'm hoping. So I've set it up. It's GoFund.me/MWG2015. Stands for Miss Wheelchair Georgia 2015.
Well, for you taking the time to come on the show, I'll give you the $595 to reach your goal.
Thank you so much.
Because the Sports Joc love the kids. He's just he's a good guy like that. Free football camps. GoFundMe.
At least you can say you made the goal.
Yes, I truly, truly appreciate it. You have no idea.
And thank you for letting us experience your beautiful spirit. Hopefully some of it will fall on Erica Ash.
Yeah.
All my Star Wars are beautiful. What are you saying?
Thank you, boo.
and we going to smoke one after this.
If I hadn't ran out of time, I had an ocean candidate right there. But thank you, Miss Erica Ash, for coming in today.
Of course.
For the funny man, Big Kenny. Miss Leslie Peoples from the Sports Joc. Pay your taxes. Enjoy your Monday. We'll see you next Monday. Peace.
Damn this love I have in